Martin had a dream. Kendrick have a dream. All my life I want money and power. Respect my mind or die from less y'all. I pray my get big as the Eiffel Tower so I can f*** the world for 72 hours. Damn, I feel amazing. Damn, I'm in the matrix. My mind is living on cloud nine and this nine is never on vacation. Start up that Maserati and vroom, vroom, I'm racing. Popping f***s in the lobby and I pray they don't find her. Then I pray you niggas is aging. Shooters go after Judas. Jesus Christ, if I live life on my knees, ain't no need to do this. Park it in front of looters. Next to that church is chicken. All you f***s is losers. All my niggas is winners. Screaming all my life, I want money and power. Respect my mind or die from less, y'all. I pray my dick get big as the Eiffel Tower so I can fuck the world for 72 hours. Damn, I got bitches. Damn, I got bitches. Damn, I got bitches. Wifey, girlfriend, and mistress. All my life, I want money and power. Respect my mind or die from less, y'all. I got 25 lighter on my dresser. Yes, sir, put fire to that body cast on a stretcher. And her body got that a ruler couldn't measure. And it make me fast, but I never get embarrassed. And I recognize you have what I've been wanting since that record that Adina Howard had. Pop it fast to impress her. She rolling, I'm holding my been posing. This voice here is golden, so f*** y'all, I goes in. And all my life I want money and power. Respect my mind or die from this show. I pray my get big as the Eiffel Tower so I can fuck the world for 72 hours. Damn, I got bitches. Damn, I got bitches. Damn, I got bitches. Wifey, girlfriend, and mistress. All my life I want money and power. Respect my mind on. It's go time. I'm rolling dough with a good grind and I run out with a bouton. That's a relay race with a bouquet. They say, K, you gon' marry mine. B.R. No way. B.R. No way. B.R. No way. B.R. Okay, I'm never living life confined. It's a failure, even if I'm blind. I can tell you who, what, when, where, how to sell your game right on time. B.R. Go play. B.R. Go play. B.R. Go play. Y'all look like OJ killing everything from to a motherfucking hit boy bitch shit. Poppin' and I got options like an audible. I be C-O-M-P-T-O-N. I win, then ball at your defeat. C-O-M-P-T-O-N. My city mobbin' in the street. Yeah,
all's my life I has to fight, nigga. All's my life I hard times like, yeah. Bad trips like, yeah. Nazareth, I'm fucked up, homie, you fucked up. But if God got us, then we gon' be alright.
Nigga, we gon' be alright. Nigga, we gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright. Nigga, we gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Nigga, we gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright.
And when I wake up, I recognize you looking at me for the pay cut. Bahamas, I be looking at you from the face down. My Mac 11 even boom with the bass down. Skimming, and let me tell you about my life. Painkillers only put me in the twilight. With pretty pussy and Benjamin is the highlight. I tell my mama I love her, but this what I like. Lord knows, 20 of them in my Chevy. Tell them all to come and get me, reaping everything I sow. So my karma come in heaven, no preliminary hearings on my record. I'm a motherfucking gangster in silence for the record. Tell the world I know it's too late. Boys and girls, I think I've gone crazy. Trying to side my vices all day. Won't you please believe when I say, when you know we've been hurt, been down before. Nigga, when our pride was low, looking at the world like, where do we go? Nigga, and we hate po-po, when the killer's dead in the street for sure. Nigga, I'm at the preacher's door. My knees getting weak and my gun might blow, but we gon' be alright.
Nigga, we gon' be alright. Nigga, we gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright. Nigga, we gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Nigga, we gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright.
What you want? You a house, you a car, 40 acres and a mule, a piano, a guitar, anything. See, my name is Lucy. I'm your dog.
I remember you was conflicted, misusing your influence. Sometimes I did the same.
These lost guitar. thousand sway. If you exercise your right to work it out. It's true. Shout out to the birthday girl. Say hey, hey, say hey. Everyone deserves a night to play. Play, she plays. Only when you tell her no.
If these walls get dark, I can feel your rain when it cries. Gold lives inside of you.
If these walls get dark,
I love it when I'm in it.
Walk and talk, they tell me to swim good. No boat, I float better than he would. No life jacket, I'm not the guard of Nazareth. But your flood can be misunderstood. War telling me they're full of pain, resentment. Need someone to live in them just to relieve tension. Me, I'm just a tenant. Landlord said the wall vacant more than a minute. The wall are vulnerable. Exclamation, interior pink, color coordinated. I interrogated every nook and cranny. I mean, it's still amazing. Before they couldn't stand me. These walls wanna cry tears. These.
Is it anything and everything you offer? I didn't feel it like you. I didn't feel it like
you. Maybe the night that my tears might let me know. All the stars are closer. All the stars are closer. All the stars are closer. Maybe the night that my tears might let me know.
Tell me what you gon' do to me. Confrontation ain't nothing new to me. You could bring a bullet, bring a sword, bring a morgue, but you can't bring the truth to me. Fuck you and all your expectations. I don't even want your congratulations. I recognize your false confidence and calculated promises. All in your conversations. I hate people that feel entitled. Look at me crazy cause I didn't invite you. Oh, you important, you the moral to the story. You endorsing, motherfucker, I don't even like you. Corrupt a man's heart with a gift. That's how you find out who you're dealing with. A smart percentage you I'm building with. I want the credit if I'm losing or I'm winning. On my mama, that's the real shit.
Let's talk about love. Is it anything you,
maybe the night that my tears might let me know. All the stars are closer.
No one play.
So you get you.
Hey.
How about Gucci? How about Bentley? At the same damn time. On the phone, cooking. At the same damn time. Telling me. At the same damn time. Too bad. At the same damn time. 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 On the pool, on the mark. At the same damn time. On the soap, body bottom. At the same damn time.
Gucci made it. Yeah. Barely felt I'm killing. The way I rock a Jimmy Choo, the world got out, I'm dealing it. I'm for Sheila, don't touch it, she got business. Busting down them Benjamin, get up on Louis. That's the way I'm kicking it. Pharaoh brought my cover me. Puerto Rican, Japanese, we laid up at the double tree. Yellow ice above my beat. Pinky ring, quarter key. iPhone, Metro, twerking out the whole thing. My ear ring, jelly bean. Gangsta leaning, Irene. Red eyes, no visine. I'm loped out on the green. Hard shoes on my jeans. Riding jeans with the wings. Yellow bone on my team. Traffic in them Yamis. Face boots with the spikes. Go to AZ on the flight. Mel 100 overnight.
How about Gucci? How about Bentley? At the same damn time. On the phone, cooking. At the same damn time. Tell me.
telling me. At the same damn time. Two bad, bad. At the same damn time. 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 On the good, on the more. At the same damn time. On the sofa, by the bar. At the same damn time. I'm in filth with the set going crazy. Got some damage around my neck. No fugazi. Sweet, trying to baby.
For real.
Just a young hood, hood, beach raise me.
Yeah.
If you want a unit, trying to scratch it to another wheel. Drinking on the Epiphany, tasting like a bubble gum. Thumbing through the check, check. Pouring on the jet, check. Talking on the iPhone. Sipping at the styrofoam. That dirty got my mind blown. That money got my mind blown. BBS and White Stone. BBS and White Stone.
Here's a little something for the players out there hustling, getting down for theirs. From East Point, College Park, Decatur.
Man, the scene is so thick. Low rise.
Rest in peace to Rico Wade, baby.
77 Seville's, L Dog, nothing but them lacks. All the players,
Sport in the house.
All the hustlers. I'm talking about a black man in heaven here. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
like that. Yeah, lights are coming from everywhere. Yeah. Football vibe is good cause love is everywhere. To all your fellas and your pimps, look at it everywhere. And if your home is empty, please then
put her on the wall. Na na na, everybody's dancing and just feeling right. I see all of you players got your sauce making on ice. I hope when all doubt this is over.
Time again, see, I be thinking about that future. Back in the day when we were slaves, I bet we was some cool ass name. But now we want to slap my nigga back out to make his ass black out. Or even pull your bucket hit it to make his whole crew believers. You harder than a bitch, so pull that dick, but that don't be sounding like king shit to me. See, now in the ghetto, or should I be saying Lakewood? You better be strapped, cause the niggas over there just ain't good. Just being a hustler, serving the loyal customers. Of the month, so I'm hustling. I buy you 50 box of Phillies at the Sicko. And nigga be wanting drinks and shit from the fucking snow, yo. But that's a hype though, cause I be getting paid. And every trip I take, there's a dollar to be made. I'm digging through my pockets, but my earnings got too high. Yeah, it is. Now it's time to smoke that night. If you smoke a night, then I'll smoke a night.
Time is slipping, slowly but surely. Niggas I used to hang with wants to act like they don't know me. Come and listen to my story. I got a lot of shit up on my mind. I wipe the boo-boo from my brain. Then I finish up my rhyme, take a number. I caught you in the slumber. I hit you for a lick. I'm in the slammer for the summer. But now it is the fall. I'm having a ball, making my nickels act sprawl. Cause my niggas got to serving when they beeping, when they call. I got that beat of ball and plus that Mary Jane. I'm rolling reefer out of a Rego. How can I refrain? From being rough, from being tough, from being dangerous. I'm hanging with the V8 niggas. Ain't no danger in us. You can try, if you don't, just don't. If you wanna battle, it's either that you will or you won't. See, that rap shit is really just like selling smoke. If you
yes, sir.
Let me dig into your brain. Folks falling like rain. Property got me selling things. Guess I'm gonna explain. Jane is rolled up. No gangs beats rolled up. But still, Andre got action. They sweat like keep all of my teeth. I take it upon myself to handle mine. Thinking that you got several time to do this. Have you shot up about you knew this? I'm probably no type of problem. Selling my sacks. Watching my back. Wetting them up like slish. Leaving them in a flash of blood. The clock is ticking. these niggas from my pockets missing. I'm putting it down like it be hot before we all get shot. Got only so much time in this bastard. Been be claiming bro, but I be saying they procrastinating. Settling for less, better be ready when they roll up in your nest and sink one in your chest and it's gone. Up out of here for good. Y'all be bobbing back and forth to let me know you understood. Yeah, what's up?
There's so much time left in this crazy world. I'm just crumbling there. I'm just crumbling there. Niggas killing niggas, they don't understand. I'm just crumbling there. I'm just crumbling there.
So check me out, see, once in a while when niggas be trying to test me, I get thirsty, grab a pint, I'm going in whiskey, then they swing, but shit, they miss me, huh? I'm getting nice with them things, because I do like that, you heard me on the radio, and yes, my man, I'm true to that. I run my lyrics the way I want to hear them, and she...
Revolutionary, scary, thought-provoking, spoken words of a change I don't feel, but I see visions for me at 23, making it free in my community. One day is what I live for, ain't thinking about no hope no more. I got my boots, I kick until I get weak. Adapt and overcome, oh hum hum. Go get my gun, load up for fun, and put it down with the frown. What goes round comes round from MLK to Cascade. I know it's through them plenty figures, cocaine dealers throw the walk signs up in their rhymes. Looking cleaner than I seen them the last time. They selling dimes, now it's quarter keys, stacking G's in the South Indies. My nigga, them folks riding bosses. I'm all vehicles up in the hood. Knowing each and every nigga selling. But can you blame? In fact, the only way your brother can survive the gas. It's my heart to get by. Dope dealing, fatal killings, and bedtime. To write rhyme, it ain't just the police. We kill each other, just drop some other brother fast living to get you took. Thinking it can't happen to you, and then it do. Oh, crooked schemes, that's the dream. Throw face down in the mainstream.
Like it is when it ain't all bitches and cream. That's why some five folks face down in the mainstream.
Let me get a chop at this lumber. Niggas from down underground, they hanging around the A-town. Looking for a come-up, working from 9 to 5 just to get some change, some T-Mo, to stay alive. Not greedy and living lavish shit, but you can bet that when I do, nobody from my crew will I forget. If I start to get large and come up on some change, I won't change. Everybody know it down. It's not the same everyday life, can be different. These laws got me ready to blow, cause I'm all a victim. So I still be slanging them back pedals to make them meet each and every day as I comb my city streets. Sometimes I wish I never had been a part of this mess, cause the system got us fucked up. They put us to the test, women and men. If you black, you in. Food for the soul. Listen to what I tell you. It don't matter, young or old. It's time we look up and do like we supposed. We killing each other over this bullshit and some clothes. We shot up in this world society with no place else to go.
So how you feel? Frustrated, irritated. Sometimes I don't know myself. I be too numb to feel something sometimes. So I dig deep, get into Cherokee. Let my mind fly free into the wilderness so I can get this shit off my mind. That's why I be smoking that thing sometimes.
Can't tell me this ain't one of the sickest verses of all time.
We shot up in this world society with no place else to go.
Watch how Cujo come in. Watch him, watch him.
So how you feel?
Frustrated, irritated. Sometimes I don't know myself. I be too numb to feel something sometimes. So I dig deep, get into Cherokee. Let my mind fly free into the wilderness so I can get this shit off my mind. That's why I be smoking that dank sometimes. It keeps me from snapping, keeps me calm, keeps my mind open, keeps me fun. The what I got to do, I finish studio to get my old bird back on the feet. And my my little bro in Statesboro, and my little cuz Mark Twain. All my folks that hang with me when I was out in the trap, or when I was going through what I ever sold. Only God knows what I go through. So I get down on my knees. Sometimes I come home too high to pray, but I get on my bed, lay on my back, and meditate. Anyway, get a shit.
Now see, since this Texas boy up here talking about I'm old, I'ma play some
love
shit.
It, man.
25 lighters on my dresser, yes sir. I got stuck to pay, hey,
we got 25 lighters on the dresser.
Let's see how old his ass is.
Yes, sir. Got to get paid. I got 25 fighters for my 25 foes. About to break the mic, then break 25 bows. About to rip the track with about 25 flows. And I'm dipping like a Mac with about 25 hoes.
There you go. I knew you was an old man too, nigga.
25-5, carry diamonds in my brain. 25-12s in the trunk, got the bang. Make moves to make a quick 25 mil. Come up so I can knock off Big 99 Seville. Got to take me by 25 yellow bones home. Doing bad to make them 25 phones home. Call daddy, tell him 25 got the gold. DMV them, put it down, 25 out the door.
Shit, Zero the Crook. I know y'all been waiting on this hill. Yeah. Shit. R.I.P. Big Mello. Screw. Mafio, Big Boo. Gator. All the problem soldiers, man. South side, east side, west side, north side. You know what I'm saying? All my partners are your dead partners. But shit, I still feel stressed. Still gotta get something off my chest. Why these whole niggas be doing what they be doing? I don't know though. Shit, fuck it. We don't stay too deep in the photo. Slow lighting, banging all in my trunk. Trunk full of funk. I ain't never been a punk. I blow on skunk. I blow on Doja. Military minded. I'm a motherfucking soldier. Out the streets of the bitch, unfold. Not no bitch, and see, I still ain't a hoe. Niggas know every day of the year. I pimp my pen and I get my point clear. Why niggas wanna talk down? I don't know. Gotta take a trip to Acapulco from the foe. With my fofo on my side when I ride, ready to do another homicide in the blind by till I'm gone. Nigga, old glory. I'm H Town to Kelly just like Robert Horry. If I do.
And about to lose my mind. And about to lose my mind.
Anyway, let me go. What's up? How y'all doing tonight? How y'all doing? Hope y'all doing Gucci. I'm doing Gucci. I'm chilling. I'm, you know, just get out the sauna like always, you know. Hit the bag. I just started hitting that bag, boy. Nigga hands getting lethal, boy. Y'all niggas better watch it. Boy, them hands getting quick, boy. Them hands, that footwork getting impeccable. Footwork, head work. I'm comfortable. I'm feeling good. Nigga might step in there. Might see where I'm at. I might need to see where I'm at. I ain't sparred in a minute. I need to see where I'm at, man. You know what I'm saying? I want to see how these hands is. You know, I'm feeling good, feeling agile and swift. You know, it is what it is. Feeling good, feeling myself. You know, I ain't on TRT or no shit like that. Just feeling good. Just high on life. What's up, man? How y'all doing? Hope y'all had a beautiful weekend. I did. Went home, saw some family, you know, just got back yesterday. I just went ahead and came back early yesterday and just hung out today with the fam. You know, now I got to buy another damn lawnmower. Damn. I got to buy another lawnmower. I don't know why, but I do. You know what I'm saying? I just bought that damn lawnmower about 2 years ago. I got to buy another one. This yard is starting to grow. I tried to get out there today. I said, man, I'm going to cut it myself. Shit. Couldn't do it. Damn lawnmower broke on me. I sat there. I called a dude. He came over, put a new carburetor, everything. Still didn't work. I don't know what happened, man. I don't know. But we here. We live. And we ready to go. So today's video is going to be a little interesting because today I'm going to talk about a subject that I think you guys will appreciate. Now, one of the main things that I've always disagreed with in this space is the idea that high value men cheat. and that high value men really don't cheat. They just exercise their options, right? A high value man is a man that, you know, goes out and does things at his own will because he got money. And, you know, when we say high value, we talking 1%ers, okay, or higher. So we talking 800,000, maybe more, 900,000 a year in earnings. Value, a net worth of north of at least $1 million, but really with comfortable, true, like whales, you're looking at about $10 million or more per year. I mean, our net worth, right? So we're talking some dogs. And those guys usually are viewed as, you know, the famous rapper. And you can always tell someone that hasn't really been around wealthy people. And I guess what helped me, this is what helped me. Years ago, my brother graduated college, and his first job was a stockbroker. And Lord, I wish he had kept just toughed it out on that stockbroker job. I really wish he had just toughed it out. But anyway, because if he'd have toughed it out, the guy that he started with, they both were struggling. Man, that dude about a year and a half later had made $12 million in the last 12 months. But, and then I'm so stupid. I'm so in love with basketball at the time. He asked me to be his apprentice, and my dumb ass said no. That's one of the biggest regrets of my life. I never say I don't have no regrets. Like, that's a moment I regret all over basketball. Because I thought I was going to make it to the league, because at the time I was playing at run and shoot, and all these people was hyping my head up like I was a real ball player. And I had a shot, and I had just talked to Elmore Spencer from the UNLV running reps, if y'all remember those running reps back in the day. And I had met with him, and he was up there talking about, man, you know, you're a hell of a ball player, man. I like players like you. You know, you could probably play D1. And my head is just big. So I'm like, shit, I'm that shit. And he said, hey, man, you want to come up here and learn? Yeah, I'll teach you. Dude, I'm single, 19, 20 years old, no kids, in Atlanta. And I said no. Boy, that was a big mistake, right? This was after my brother saw him, and my brother was talking to me. I was like, nah, man, I don't want to do that. Stupid. Anyway, I'm talking about myself. You know, it is what it is, right? But at any rate, I guess one of the things we want to talk about is the idea that that high-value men are going to cheat. They have the right to cheat. So if you're going to marry or date a high-value man, he has to step out, because that's just how it works. He's high-value, right? And one of the problems that you're going to run into with that is when you're talking about single, right? Single high-value men versus, you know, high-value men that aren't single. You have to divide this up. So you're talking about a fraction of a percent of men that make up this class. Most of them are married, and you're about to find that out, right? And it's a lot of other characteristics about these guys that I was listening to this yesterday. I was like, man, you know. But I want you guys to really pay attention to this, because that's the thing. It's like a lot of people get so sidetracked with these damn YouTube videos. And a lot of these people have not been around true high value, a lot of them. They have not been around a lot of high value men. The reason I brought up the stockbroker was when my brother was a stockbroker, he told me, because we used to see me and my brother used to ride around washing cars in Atlanta. And he told me, he said, man, you know, when you talking about high, you know, he didn't say high value, but he was just talking about people that he would call. He told me the profile of most of them. Married, in their mid to late 50s, right? Been married for a while, and we're about to get into all that. And these are the guys that are more successful than the guys that aren't. Now, are there single men that are able to amass millions of dollars? Yes, they are, right? But when you listen to this, it's not going to be what you think. Well, these guys are high value men in spite of. No, most of these guys are telling you, you'll see, and it's the thing, like when we talk about this shit, you got to study these subjects. Don't just pull shit out your ass. See, a lot of times when you listen to people like Sneeko and people like the High Value Man, Kevin Samuels type shit. But see, Kevin Samuels, for all intents and purposes, worked with a swath of people in Oklahoma, where he was from, and then he moved to Atlanta. By the time he moved to Atlanta, he wasn't really doing the consulting as much. He was more so becoming, I would say, a shock jock. And so you really don't want to put him in the category of a guy who, you know, he would probably beg to differ. He would start trying to drop his credentials and what he's done and this and that. And I'm just telling you, as a guy that's worked in IT and worked around certain black guys that are single, that make no probably making or have a net worth north of seven figures, I'm going to tell you like this. Those guys are not just master players with the women. A lot of them aren't. A lot of those guys are so entrenched in their work and so driven by what they're trying to do, they're not the most outgoing social, or should I say sociable individuals. They're not. A lot of times. They may net, but it's easy. Some of them, they may network in certain instances where they're able to network, but they're not just out here walking in the room, working the room. Where, that's a small percentage. If I had to make it out of 100% of successful single, you know, non-married individuals that are over $7 million in income, those guys, I'm talking about a small fraction of them, are going to be those social individuals. A lot of times, the guy that's going to be that is probably going to be a damn plumber or electrician, or going to be some sort of, he's going to have a trade, more than likely. Or he's either that, or he works a 9-to-5, but his parents or somebody set him up to where by the time he's 35, 40, he's already a millionaire. That's who we're talking about. But the average Joe Blow is not going to meet that criteria. He's just not. Right? I'm talking about millionaire guy. The average millionaire guy is not going to meet that. He's going to be married already, already has somebody. And I know a lot of people, you know, love to swear by Kevin Samuels. Well, he knows. Yeah, and shout out to Satan Sinner. Before they passed away, before Kevin died, Satan Sinner exposed him. And, you know, he, and if you go watch the video, I'm not trying to start no mess because the man is not here to defend himself. So I just put that clip of him saying high value men should cheat. He should. He deserves it because he has money. That's the dumbest thought process you can have. You are very, 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 like, ignorant if you think that just because you have a business or you're successful some sort of way, you have the right to step out on a woman who was there with you. Now, you can get a divorce and move on about your business. And if that's what you want to do, then do that. But a lot of these guys don't do that. And that's the thing I always want to talk about. So there's a book I've been telling y'all about that I've been listening to for years. Well, let me pause it. So let me pause it. And let me see if I can change this. Give me 1 second. There we go. So one of the things I want you guys to pay attention to with this whole situation is that The Millionaire Mind is a book by Thomas J. Stanley. Now, I'm going to go back to chapter one before we go to success factors. I want to go here first. Now, listen to what they say about it.
An introduction to The Millionaire Mind. They live in lovely homes located in fine neighborhoods. Balance is their approach to life. They are financially independent, yet they enjoy life. They are not all work, no play type of people. Most become millionaires in one generation. Neither their lifestyle nor their wealth was generated from being highly leveraged financially. They are not credit junkies. How did they accomplish this? How did they balance their need to become wealthy and economically productive with their need to enjoy life? They have the millionaire mind. Early in my career of studying wealthy people, I had a glimpse of this segment of the millionaire population. In 1983, I was asked to interview 60 millionaires from Oklahoma. What I learned from them was simple, yet the message had a lasting impact on me. You cannot enjoy life if you are addicted to consumption and the use of credit. These Oklahoma millionaires were just the opposite, as demonstrated by one focus group of 10. All 10 were seasoned business owners, executives, or professionals. All were first-generation wealthy. Some were credit-dependent earlier in their careers, but they eventually saw the light. They went cold turkey, breaking the cycle of borrowing to consume, earning to consume, and borrowing more and more money. Others never became addicted to credit or the need to display their success. All 10 were multimillionaires. They lived in fine homes in well-established older neighborhoods. They drove American-made motor vehicles. They enjoyed life. They were not workaholics. They spent a lot of time with their families and friends, borrowed little money, and became wealthy in most cases before they were 45 years old. My interview with this group was scheduled to last about 2 hours, but it actually went on for nearly 4 hours. I only had to ask a few questions. The members enjoyed telling their own stories about becoming wealthy. If there were a focus group Hall of Fame, all 10 of these millionaires would be inducted during the first round. There were many important points made about how one can become an economic success, but one statement was riveting. It was made by Gene. He mentioned that those who are credit dependent are in fact controlled by someone else, some institution. Gene was in his late 40s at the time. He listed his occupation as owner of a salvage business. He purchased or salvaged real estate from various financial institutions. These institutions have loans that are in default 6 months or more. Just a few weeks prior to the interview, Gene salvaged 68 homes, a commercial shopping center, and 5 multifamily apartment complexes from a financial institution with which he'd had many previous dealings. Immediately after the deal was signed, the senior credit officer of the institution signaled to Gene and walked with him over to the large window in the officer's top floor office. It was a tall building they could see for miles and miles. There were thousands upon thousands of commercial buildings all around. Gene could even see some of the residential neighborhoods on the horizon. As he looked out the window, the officer pointed to all the build-ins, homes, offices, garages, shops, and so on, and said the words that made a lasting impression on Gene. "We, the lenders, own it all. All of it. The business out there?"
That was just me trying to get you an introduction to the type of spirit of it. He did another survey. It's not just those 60, but you have to get the book. I'm not trying to go through the whole entire book. I just want to go to this next section.
Success factors. Are you confused? America is supposed to be the land of opportunity. But after years of searching and studying opportunities, you're overwhelmed. Everyone you consulted has a unique formula for becoming an economic success in America, and you've spoken to many, many people. When you ask these people if you can see their balance sheets, the evidence of their net worth, most say that they will be rich tomorrow, and their current economic status is totally irrelevant. But it is very relevant to you. You are a seeker of truth. Just what are the factors that underlie financial success in America? Each week, you stop by the Quickie Mart and buy gasoline. You pay with cash. As a result, you often get stuck in line with people waiting to buy lotto tickets. So you ask the question of questions. Is lotto the way to become rich, economically successful, in America? They all tell you the same thing. Wealth is all about luck. And lotto is the most direct way to Millionairesville. Yet none of these people appear to be millionaires. Many even have holes in their shoes. Then you stop by your local bank. Again, you ask about the road to wealth. The teller says it's all about CDs. While you are in line, a man standing behind you introduces himself. Johnny Brown is an insurance agent. He whispers in your ear, whole life and annuities. He says he can provide you with the key to economic success. Just stop by my office today, he tells you. You decline his offer. Instead, you stop by the local high school because it's your child's parent-teacher day. While you are there, 5 teachers all say the same thing. Economic success is a direct mathematical function of one's grades in school. But many of these less successful people were once A students. Are they exceptions to the rule? How is it possible that some A students are not economically successful? You are now more confused than ever. So you go home to relax. The TV is on and your children are channel surfing. On one of the cable channels, a fellow says you can be rich if you listen to his audio tapes. The tapes are specially priced at $399 plus shipping. On the next channel, a woman is selling her professional matchmaking services. She claims the way to Millionairesville is through marriage. Too bad, you are already married. Just then your phone rings. It's a cold calling stockbroker. He wants to send you his card and other information. While you have him on the phone, you ask him the question of questions about economic success. He tells you that he is the way to wealth in America. He is the only person in America who can sell you shares in a company that just discovered a cure for AIDS. So you ask him to send you a copy of his financial statement. For some reason, he hangs up on you. And on it goes. The fellow on the radio this morning says you get rich with soybean futures. The lady who owns the local jewelry store tells you the key is owning investment-grade gems. The local antiques dealer says you just can't believe how many people have become rich in the antiques business. Members of your son's rock band tell you it's all about rock and roll. Most of the kids on the high school basketball team tell you that wealth in America is a sure thing if you are an athlete. On a special Saturday last fall, the kids lining up to take the SAT told you it's the SAT numbers. Score big and you go to a great college and then get big bucks later in life. Mr. Aladdin down at the lighting store promises something different. If you buy his special brand of lamp, a genie will appear and make you richer than you can imagine. It is very confusing, all this information about the keys to becoming economically successful. How did millionaires become rich in America? The best way to answer this question is to ask them. What factors explain your economic success? The 733 millionaires who responded to my survey were asked to rate 30 success factors. The list is not an exhaustive one.
These were Deca millionaires, by the way. That's 10 million or more.
It was,
well, most of them were, he said.
Distilled from more than 100 success factors mentioned by millionaires who participated in a series of preliminary.
We'll go to the choice of spouse chapter in a second, but I just want to kind of give you an understanding. Because, see, the thing is, when we talk about high value, I want you to notice what these guys do. They're not your typical traditional high value idea of what a high value guy. He's a multimillionaire. He's flying in private jets. He just look at what he's describing. He's describing a dude you'll see riding up and down the street. You never know his ass is a millionaire. You would never know.
Preliminary personal and focus group interviews I conducted. However, the 30 success factors selected were among those most often mentioned and represented many redundant factors. Most millionaires place importance on pathways to success that are far different from those cited earlier. Becoming wealthy is the product of elements that are more fundamental than soybeans, life insurance, or the lotto. It's even more basic than grade point average, SAT scores, or graduating at the top of one's class, as the list demonstrates. The following sections discuss these real success factors in detail. I have grouped them into response clusters as follows. Social skills. Getting along with people. Having strong leadership qualities. Having an ability to sell my ideas, products, etc. Having good mentors. Orientation toward critics. Ignoring the criticism of detractors. Having a competitive spirit or personality. Having the urge to be well-respected. Having extraordinary energy. Being physically fit. Integrity and moral values. Being honest with all people, having a supportive spouse, having strong religious faith. Creative intelligence, seeing opportunities others do not see, finding a profitable niche, specializing, loving my career or business. Investing, the stock market or one's own business. Investing in the equities of public corporations, having excellent investment advisors, making wise investments, investing in my own business, being my own boss, willing to take financial risk given the right return, living below my means. Luck versus discipline. Being lucky, being well-disciplined, being very well-organized, working harder than most people. Intellectual orientation. Having a high IQ or superior intellect, attending a top-rated college, graduating near or at the top of my class. The intellectual orientation is of particular interest. I have compared it to the social skills cluster and to the clusters concerned with orientation toward critics, integrity, and creative intelligence. Although many people would predict that intellectual orientation, high IQ and such, would outrank the factors in each of these clusters, the data prove exactly the opposite. The dawning in Birmingham, high intellect versus social skills. I arrived in Birmingham, Alabama just before dawn on a foggy winter Monday. My seminar was scheduled to begin at 8:30 a.m., but I arrived nearly an hour early and had the opportunity to chat with some of the 200 executives in attendance during the pre-seminar continental breakfast. A senior sales executive, I'll call him Hugh, told me that he had played for Coach Paul Bear Bryant at Alabama. During our conversation, I learned a great deal about the factors that accounted for this executive's success in business. I wasn't surprised by some of the things Hugh told me. He mentioned that there were several other executives in the room who had played football for the Bear, and I recalled meeting others all over America who played football for Coach Bryant. There was something particularly compelling about Paul Bear Bryant's extraordinary achievements. His teams won many football championships and were often number one. Even before I met Hugh that foggy winter morning, I recognized that productivity was Coach Bryant's hallmark. He established a superlative record without being number one in spending or by recruiting talent from 50 states. I wanted to ask why Coach Bryant was so successful, but thought it might take hours for this former football player to respond. So I asked Hugh a different question. What was the first thing Coach Bryant said to you and the other scholarship athletes after you arrived on campus? Surprisingly, Coach Bryant asked the group, "Have you called your folks yet to thank them?" According to Hugh, after hearing those words, the players looked confused. Most had their mouths open. They looked at one another with disbelief. Apparently, not one of them had anticipated this question. These freshman athletes had been on campus less than 24 hours, but they already had their first lesson in team productivity. I understand that no one in the room that day acknowledged having called home with words of thanks. What was the essence of this lesson? Hugh said that Coach Bryant followed up his initial question with a second statement. No one ever got to this level without the help of others. Call your folks. Thank them. In other words, the coach had news for these gifted freshmen. Extraordinary natural athletic talent does not fully account for success in football. Without their folks nurturing, protecting, and sacrificing for them, they would not have had the opportunity to play football at Alabama. Hugh told me that he never forgot this initial experience. It served him and his teammates well during 4 very successful years playing football. He also gives much credit to this and related lessons from the coach for his success and achievements in business. It's rare that anyone becomes successful without the assistance of others. A group of individuals, no matter how gifted, is not a team at all. How many running backs became All-Americans without their linemen opening up opportunities? 0. Becoming wealthy in America is very similar. I have never met one affluent person who takes complete credit for his economic success. Most will give credit to their spouse, key employees, mentors, and others. No man or woman is an island, whether the context is sports, business, or building wealth. Nobody gets to the highest peaks without the help of others. It may be relatively easy to perform well when certain conditions are present. You may be on a very talented team playing much weaker opponents. Or your business and net worth may be skyrocketing under favorable economic conditions. But what if the opponent is very strong, or market conditions are unfavorable to your business? Then you won't even have a chance to win if you don't seek and nurture important human resources. Without such support, you will probably be overwhelmed. Fear and worry will set in. Fear is the mother of panic, and panic is the precursor of bad decisions and ultimate failure. As demonstrated in my survey, throughout life, most successful people go out of their way to attract, motivate, appreciate, and nurture key advisors, suppliers, and employees. Superior social skills versus superior intellect. Note how valuable the coach's message was in view of the results of this survey of a large number of economically productive adults, millionaires. How do they account for their enormous productivity? Is it a matter of being born with superior intellect? Not at all. Nearly all of the millionaires surveyed, 94%, rated getting along with people as either very important, 56%, or important, 38%, in accounting for their economic success. Based on the percentage of respondents who rated it as very important, this factor ranked 3rd in overall importance relative to the other 29 success factors studied. So whether it be in sports or business, one's ability to get along is critical. Yet far too many of us believe that success is predetermined, a direct result of genetics, and that successful people just have higher IQs than those who are less successful. So what if you receive all A's in school and near-perfect SATs? So what if your IQ is in the ozone layer of the intelligence scale? Will these factors assure you of a place among the ranks of America's millionaires? It's doubtful if you don't get along with people. This is not just my view. The large sample of millionaires surveyed was asked about the importance of intellect in explaining their economic success. Only 1 in 5, 20%, felt that having a high IQ or superior intellect was very important. Superior intellect ranked 21st on the list. 2 other measures of intellect were found to be highly correlated with this factor. Only about 1 in 10, 11%, indicated that graduating near the top of my class, and only about 1 in 7, 15%, felt that attending a top-rated college were very important elements in explaining their economic success. Some millionaires do feel that their IQ was a factor in their successful achievements, although most others feel just the opposite. This can be accounted for in part by considering the occupational groups that tend to rate their IQ as an important factor. Millionaire attorneys are first in line, followed by physicians. The rationale is obvious because, as a general rule, one must score high on standardized tests to be admitted to either law school or medical school, and these board scores are high correlates of IQ. If the millionaire attorneys and physicians are netted out of the national sample, these 2 groups combined account for nearly 1 in 5 millionaires, the importance of intellect declines significantly. There is another interesting result of removing the data from attorneys and physicians from the sample. The importance of getting along with people and other social skill factors is even more pronounced. Note that 61% of the millionaires in the business owner or entrepreneur category and 59% of the senior corporate executives feel that getting along with people is very important. A significantly smaller percentage of attorneys, 43%, and physicians, 47%, rated this factor as being very important. This isn't surprising when you consider that a successful executive or business owner is more often part of a team than most attorneys or physicians. But in all vocational categories, social skills overall are rated higher by more respondents than are the intellectual factors. The 4 components of the social skills domain are highly significant correlates.
So we don't want to, I'm not going to play this whole thing. I wanted to go to, I thought I was going to go to, what's the name? But let me just go to choice of spouse. This is the chapter that really kind of speaks to the actual high value piece. As far as, you don't say the word high value, but the reason I'm saying what I'm saying, you'll notice the patterns of these types of people, the type of women they choose to be with and their success over 20 and how they, and you'll see, man, it's not, and this is more, there's more of a, I would think that there is more of a, of information to say that millionaire men ain't just out there just hoeing around. The higher you go on the economic ladder, people ain't getting divorced. And it's not that they're not getting divorced because, oh, my husband's so rich, he can step out and I'm just happy because he got me in Gucci and gold. That's television, man. That's rap. That's sports. That's athletes. When I hear people say that, I know they haven't been around real a bunch of high-value people. They hadn't. They haven't spoken to them. You have not been around a lot of high-value men when you say shit like that. You've been around a bunch of celebrities and athletes and rappers and shit, rubbing shoulders with niggas like Diddy or somebody. You think that's the normal. All men are like, you know, well, no Diddy, obviously. But you know what I'm saying? All the men out here, they multiple. They got multiple women in every city. They this, they that. No, that is not the case. And you'll see that as he talks about this in this chapter.
Choice of spouse. Can you live forever? Marry the wrong spouse, and every day will feel like an eternity. Marry the right spouse, and life will be a joyful and perhaps even a rich experience. A rocky road. Several booking agents have told me there are 5 top-rated conventions held annually in this country, and an invitation to be a main platform presenter at any of them indicates genuine superstar status on the lecture circuit. That made me somewhat nervous when I was invited to speak at one of those conventions, the Million Dollar Round Table, a trade association composed of the world's top-producing life insurance agents. At the time, I was a college professor from Georgia State University, but the head of the speaker selection committee read about me in the Wall Street Journal and liked the idea of having an expert on millionaires address his colleagues. I've never thought of myself in the superstar category, but there I was in front of 14,000 people, along with distinguished speakers like Eunice Shriver, Marvin Hamlisch, and Lee Iacocca. Another speaker on the platform that day was a former football player who had an outstanding professional career and had played in 4 Super Bowls, in spite of being wounded in the Vietnam War. This player was a delightful, down-to-earth man who had made a successful transition from pro football to celebrity speaker status. Every important group wanted to hear him because he was an excellent speaker. He could write his own ticket, demand considerable fees, and be very selective in his choice of clients. Few men can play ball at that level and then become a star in a completely different field, so I suspected he was unusually talented and would surely become an economic success for the rest of his adult life. Surprisingly, I never heard anything about this player again until our local newspaper, the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, published a story stating that this player, now bankrupt, was hawking his Super Bowl rings. How could it be that a fellow with considerable talent for earning a high income turns up as the subject of a newspaper story detailing his bankruptcy? There it was in black and white. The player, who overcame Vietnam War wounds to play in 4 Super Bowls, filed for Chapter 7 bankruptcy 2 days after selling his championship rings to help pay back federal taxes. The article went on to say, his former wife said in a countersuit that he just wants to avoid paying her $837,948 from the sale of their home. In the bankruptcy petition he filed, the player stated that he had already paid his ex-wife $1.3 million in cash and property. Could it be that his economic reversals were related to his divorce? Divorce generally has a devastating impact on an individual's net worth, and that's true for both millionaires and non-millionaires. Since 92% of the millionaire households in America are composed of a married couple, and these millionaire couples have less than 1/3 the divorce rate of non-millionaire couples, we can conclude that here is another factor that distinguishes the millionaire mind: the ability to choose the right mate for life. Being divorced doesn't exclude one from becoming and remaining a millionaire. It just makes it significantly more difficult.
One of the things that I'm going to go ahead and just cheat a little bit, let me tell you, because already one of the things he talked about was people in faith-based families that where they following traditional family values. That is one of the deciding factors as far as success in marriage and in business. In fact, people from faith-based situations had higher net worths than people that didn't, that weren't, as they put it, religious. So this book really outlines a lot of different things. Now, you know, what's funny is everything he's talking about lines up with what we talk about in the book of Ecclesiastes and in Proverbs. And just throughout the Bible, throughout the scriptures, you see following the wisdom of what this book is talking about and looking at what it says and then looking at the word and how and applying that and living it actually lends to success. And so this is just a very, you know, small swath into it. Let's get to it.
As this player may have discovered. The economic productivity of marriage. Studies have consistently found a significant correlation between length of marriage and wealth accumulation. One study of over 12,000 respondents, Does Marital History Matter? The Effect of Marital Status on Wealth Outcomes Among Pre-Retirement Age Adults, by Janet Wilmoth and Gregor Koso, is particularly illuminating. The authors found that consistent participation in marriage results in significantly higher wealth. Conversely, those people who are not married continuously over time have a propensity to accumulate lower levels of wealth during their adult life cycle. What is it about marital status that affects one's level of wealth? According to the research conducted by Wilmoth and Coso, legal marriages have certain institutionalized features that are conducive to accumulating wealth, an important one being the division of labor within the marital relationship. Also, certain economies of scale are present in a married couple household that are not normally associated with a single-person household. The positive correlation between length of marriage and level of wealth is very strong and holds true throughout all education and income groups in America. Millionaires and marriage. What would happen today if all the millionaire couples in America immediately broke up? Of course, there would be a lot more singles heading up millionaire households. There would also be one-third fewer millionaire households because their assets have to be divided. Domestic overhead would double and legal fees would take a nice share. But like the rest of the population, millionaires stay married because of reasons other than economics. Millionaires, and those who will probably attain this status, have a unique ability to select mates with a certain set of qualities. Some of these qualities are significant in explaining their long-term happy marriages, while other traits are more directly related to wealth accumulation. People who stay married for the full term, till death do us part, tend to be unselfish, caring, forgiving, patient, understanding, disciplined, and virtuous. It also helps if the couple has similar interests, activities, and...
See, let me tell you something, man. You hear people, and usually, I hate to say this, be a lot of broke people that say this, and I'm not trying to insult them, but there's a lot of people that aren't successful. When you hear people talking about, oh, well, the only reason old people stayed married was because they're miserable and they just had to stay together because of this and stay because of that. That's no longer the case when you're talking about the 80s and 90s. That's not the case. You got people that was married all, they still an old couple and they married 40 years ago. They still were young enough. If they wanted to get away, they could. 30 years ago, they could have easily left each other. See, in my day, my grandparents, you talking about people that came through the Civil War, not Civil War, damn, through World War II, Vietnam, that's different. But today, when you see an old couple and they in their 70s and 60s, technically, they graduated high school in the 80s. That's somebody graduated high school in the 80s, in the 60s, in their 60s. And somebody that is from, you graduated high school in the 70s, early 70s, that's the person that's probably going to be in their 70s, you know what I'm saying, in their 70s, early 70s. So you're not talking about people that came out during segregation and, you know, with sharecroppers, and that's bullshit. Okay? These people stayed together for other reasons than that, but let's keep going.
Opinions. Like Tina Turner, you may ask, what's love got to do with it? Underlying any happy marriage are love and deep affection, but affection can cloud one's judgment. If you are deeply in love with a potential spouse who lacks traits like patience and understanding, you may give him or her grades that are too high because of your emotional involvement. Only later, through direct experience prior to your divorce, are you able to recognize your spouse's shortcomings. The millionaires I have interviewed seem to have early warning systems. They have the uncanny ability to determine if a prospective spouse is unselfish, caring, and virtuous before they become emotionally involved, and that accounts for the high frequency of full-term marriages in this group. Ask the prototypical millionaire who has been married to the same spouse 25, 35, or even 50 years, what can you tell me about your spouse? Among the first things they say include down-to-earth, unselfish, has traditional values, my emotional backbone, patient, understanding. There is an
traditional value. Didn't I tell y'all? Let's go.
Even more revealing question. What was it that initially attracted you to your spouse? Respondents will, more often than not, mention some physical attribute. But physical attractiveness is never the only factor. Most suggest that they had some intuition about other qualities, such as those listed above, that their prospective spouse possessed. Consider the case of Barbara, Bobby, and Forrester, who have been married for more than 35 years. They have four grown children and they own and operate three manufacturing companies. They are economically successful. Bobby was raised in a small western Kansas town near the Colorado border. Forrester grew up on a farm in southern Georgia.
So guys, do you think this guy he's describing right now is the type of guy that he's clearly high value? He checks all the boxes. Married to his woman, they built the business together. Can he just step out anytime he wants to? See how childish and immature these niggas? They sound like somebody. That's some shit somebody would say from junior high school. A ninth grader would. I could see a kid in high school saying that. Any adult that's really been out here living for a while, you know better. That's why we shouldn't. That's why the shit they say, fresh and fit say, is really immature and childish. It really is. They don't understand being around. The average millionaire ain't out here riding around in Miami in a Bugatti. Trying to fuck with a bunch, trying to fuck 50 women. Raw. Like, that's not the norm. Do you have those? Yes, you have YouTube influencers. That's not reality, fam. You know what I'm saying? You got all these YouTube influencers, all of them being Miami, driving expensive cars and they doing all this, and you think that's, man, this is what millionaires do. They step out. Bullshit.
How did a girl from Western Kansas ever meet a farm boy from Southern Georgia at a college mixer in Boston? Both Bobby and Forrester came from modest backgrounds, but both were extremely bright and excelled in high school. Their families sacrificed to put together a college fund for their children, and both received additional support from academic scholarships. Forrester attended MIT. Bobby went to Wellesley. According to Forrester, the first thing I noticed was that her clothes were handmade. They were well-made, but homemade. From the very beginning, Forrester was fascinated with Bobby. Certainly she was cute and charming, but it was her wardrobe that impressed him most. Her mother had made her clothes. This fact told him a lot about Bobby's background. It was obvious that she came from a family of modest means, but nevertheless they had sent their daughter to one of the top women's colleges in America. He reasoned that both Bobby and her parents had their priorities ranked in the proper order. Bobby was impressed with Forrester's presence at MIT, given his modest background as a farm boy.
I agree with you, Friedman, but the thing is, I want to kind of dispel the myth that high-value men are cheaters and they exercise their options and they should cheat. Man, look, these men in this situation, these men he's describing in these situations would be fucked up in a heartbeat if they wouldn't want to. They wouldn't want to step out. That ain't something that they even consider.
They both had a sensitivity about their choice of an ideal spouse, and their choice has tested true for over 35 years. Bobby and Forrester were suited for each other, and they were also ideally suited to own and operate a family business. Early in their marriage, they made trade-offs between buying expensive consumer goods and funding a business. The business was their first priority. It's no wonder they are also financially successful today. No one ever became wealthy by spending the household's money on expensive consumer artifacts like clothes and new cars. No one ever became a millionaire by using consumer goods as status symbols.
I agree with you 1,000%, man. I would say I know one in particular that always comes to mind that would have been that. And I got friends that met their wives in college and got married. But now I'm thinking different. Back then, we wasn't thinking like that. In the 90s and early 2000s, people's going to college, man, he ain't getting married till I'm 30-something. That's what everybody said. But now, knowing what I know now, I would tell my son that's going to be the most options you're going to have is college. That's when if you meet somebody, go ahead and pull the trigger, man. If she really, but it going to be certain values she got to have. If she don't have those traditional values, it's like Isaac. When Isaac got his, Abraham sent a servant out to get Isaac a wife when he turned 40. And he saw, was it Rebecca? Yeah, it was Rebecca. And he said, hey, man, you know, she had need to have a heart of a servant. The servant went out and found a woman who fed his camels. And he said, hey, you know, you got the heart of a servant. I got somebody. And, you know, I got to understand, Abraham was wealthy. And so they came back, and that's how he got his wife. It was different back then. But she had a certain value. You got to put values in there, man. You can't. It's not about fat ass, pretty face. Does she have those traditional family values? That's what matters. And that's what these people are describing in this book, The Millionaire Mind, for their spouses.
While neglecting their investments in private business or publicly traded stocks. Both Bobby and Forrester learned these realities from their frugal parents. Marriage vows and the secret of washing cars. Common interests. Couples who share common interests tend to remain married, and there is a correlation between length of marriage and net worth. But the sharing of common interest and duration of a marriage are nowhere near perfect predications of wealth accumulation. If a couple has a common interest in spending all their income, they may shop together and stay married for a long time, but it's unlikely they'll ever become financially independent. So it's the types of activities and interests that a couple shares that are key. Shared interests that are related to accumulating wealth are important, including preparing a household budget, planning and making investments, setting financial goals, and owning and operating a business. Couples who share these interests are much more likely to attain millionaire status. To them, it seems a lot more sensible to purchase an expensive new car out of gains made from wise investments than from earned income. I recently bumped into an old acquaintance who told me he had just bought a boat for $23,000. He also made it clear that the purchase was funded from part of the dividends paid on just one of his investments in a public corporation. He and his wife of 12 years both enjoy boating, and they also enjoy working together on the family budget, studying investment opportunities, and planning long-term financial goals. For this couple, boating is especially enjoyable because it's not a substitute to building wealth. In fact, the boat was a reward. They rewarded each other for exceeding their goal of accumulating wealth. They purchased their boat with just a minor portion of the gains they realized from a stock purchased nearly 10 years ago. Beside the money they invested, the couple allocated a few hours of time to studying Value Line's assessment of stocks, where they discovered this particular one. They didn't even have to purchase this fine publication. They found it off the shelf in the local library. Having a common interest in wealth-building activities is a key for couples who wish to become financially independent. And the most common of these activities is owning and operating a family business, like B&D Ferguson. Neither Mr. or Mrs. Ferguson ever attended college, but their household's net worth exceeds that of most college graduates. Both were ambitious and hardworking, and had a keen interest in becoming financially independent so they could retire earlier than most couples. They reasoned that business ownership would provide them with the highest probability of achieving their goal. The couple was very careful in determining the ideal type of business. They searched for a category that had a high profit potential and found one they thought people would never recognize as generating high earnings. In their selected trade area, it had few competitors. Mrs. Ferguson told me, "Thank you for not including the car wash industry as one of the businesses of self-made millionaires. The less public attention, the better. The reality is that there are many self-made millionaires in this industry." People often ask me about the size of the investment required to start a business. The common belief is that it's always very costly. People think it takes millions to make millions. But the Fergusons had a different view. You don't necessarily need to invest millions to become economically independent if you start out with a small, efficient operation. According to Mrs. Ferguson, "At the age of 26 and 29, respectively, my husband and I leased a rundown, full-service car wash with $5,000 we borrowed from my husband's parents. $5,000 put the couple in the car wash business. It was a wise investment. 13 years later, they sold the business for $750,000. Yes, the Fergusons had found a diamond in the rough. Most other married couples wouldn't have purchased a rundown car wash. But it never bothered the Fergusons that their business wasn't glamorous and didn't denote high status or wealth. The Fergusons were never concerned that most of their customers viewed them as strictly blue-collar. Their beliefs were part of the couple's strength. Anytime one of them questioned their career decision to wash cars, it was countered with arguments like this: most car wash owners, including my husband and me, are probably better off than our college-educated professional customers. The sacrifices are definitely worth it long-term." The couple actually turned the potential disadvantage of not attending college into an advantage. They motivated themselves into being frugal and productive by constantly reminding themselves that they had accumulated more wealth than most of their well-educated, well-dressed, upscale customers. Even during hard times when it rained for several days and they had no customers, they thought of the long-term, not minor, setbacks. Long-term, we will retire with more. One in a million. Attraction and successful choices. One issue is very clear. Income and wealth are not the most important factors that account for a millionaire's successful marriage. Nor were either of these the primary factor in the initial interest they discovered for the man or woman they ultimately married. Why all this interest in what millionaires think makes up a successful marriage? The typical millionaire couple in America has been married for 28 years. One in four have been married for 38 or more years. Considering the divorce rate in contemporary America, millionaires as a group can teach us all something about finding the right mate for life.
I mean, he's saying they've been married 28 years typically on average, millionaire couples. So you don't get to know 28 years of marriage and the husband just stepping out and she cool because she in Gucci and gold. That's what I wanted to say about the high value man piece is that I feel like oftentimes we give people this, I guess, wrong idea. I ain't gonna say we, but a lot of these people in these spaces tend to, man, high value, and it's sickening to listen to. Now, I'm sure if I were on Fresh and Fit, for example, and they made that comment, I'm sure Myron would have some comeback. Well, I'm talking about single men that are millionaires, because that makes it a lot more. But I'm like, well, first of all, a lot of times, more than not, you're going to be married if you're a millionaire. That's first of all. That's just typical. The average age has went down a little bit, but not by much. A lot of people, you ain't getting becoming a millionaire until you're in your 40s. A lot of times. Maybe in your 50s. You know. Some people in their 60s, right before they retire, they just don't cross the seven-figure plateau. You know. It happens. So you can't just look at stuff from that perspective. You got to take a long-term approach. It may take that long for you to grow a business. Or it may take you that long for you to invest and get your compound interest up in your 401k or your, you know, whatever said investment properties or whatever. By the time you get to where you got that seven figure value, you probably of a certain age. That's why a lot of times when I'm riding around Atlanta and I see somebody driving in a real convertible Ferrari Modena or something, one of my favorite cars. Right, I see a guy in there. It's an old guy with gray hair most of the time, especially when you leave major metropolitan areas like Atlanta
or Miami, and you go into like a more, you know, almost, I wouldn't say rural, but just less urban, like, you know, like maybe say Birmingham compared to Atlanta or Montgomery or Jackson, Mississippi, or, you know, Greenville, South Carolina, you know, places like that. When you go to those places where you see somebody at Charleston, South Carolina, they're going to be a lot more successful. They're going to be successful. They're going to be successful in that space. They look different than the guy that got the loft in downtown Atlanta. Right? Atlanta's going to be a top five largest country, city in the country. We're going to overtake Philadelphia in the next, I don't know, they say in the next year or so. I saw somebody say that. So that's what I'm saying. So those are areas you don't want to look at and say, okay, let me set this as the tone. No, what you want to look at is, you know, even if you do look at Atlanta, that's rare. And me, you know, having traveled and been around, you know, when I was single, I was up in Atlanta all the time hanging out. I saw a lot of successful people doing well for themselves. But one thing I learned also when it comes to success, people look like they're a millionaire and they're not. A good example, a great example, is Mr. Kevin Samuels himself, Mr. Average at Best. If you look at it, this guy had an old BMW, right, coupe, like a 323 or something, a cheaper coupe, BMW coupe, and it had a major oil leak that he refused to get fixed. And he was staying in a rental. He was renting a room in Atlanta. And I'm not knocking him. Shit, he a grown man, can do what he want to do. I'm not trying to shame him. But what I'm saying is what we thought. Now, this was since after he blew up. Now, I don't know what happened. Maybe he had some back pay on stuff. But when I saw that video, I was like, dude, this is recent. He was, and the lady was going on, why you got this? You putting this oil leak out here? Y'all, everybody saw the video, right? But what it told me was, this was before he died. What it told me was he digging out the hole. He's not where he was in the hole majorly. He's trying to put himself together, get himself together. And I guess he felt like, hey, I'm not going to spend this money on my car yet. And that's his business if he wants to do that. But the reason I'm saying all this is there's no excuse for you, man. As a person, when we talk about these places, talking these spaces about these different things, there's no excuse for people, making these sweeping generalities about what it takes to be high value and what a high value. I mean, you got all this content, this red pill content about high value man. And it's a bunch of just real selfish, childish bullshit. You think that you could just get a woman who, first of all, most of us are not millionaires. Even if you're a six figure earning brother, you ain't a millionaire. Right. Most of the time. So even if you're making, you know, $200,000 a year, and you're single, and yeah, you wanted a top five, top three, somewhere in there, right? So you're doing well. But at the end of the day, you still ain't just a guy that could just step out on your woman and cheat and do whatever you want to do. And when you see guys that are in those situations, it's usually this. He's dealing with a woman that lacks values and morals anyway. A woman that has values and morals, she ain't really cool with that. She not. Everybody made fun of J.R. Smith's wife when he was messing with the girl from Flash. And everybody laughed at her when she said that prayer and everybody was laughing. Tariq was laughing at it. This man is a multimillionaire. That woman, that she wasn't cool with him stepping out. And he was, you know, it was a problem. She was, as you can see in the video, she was emotionally torn about him doing what he was doing, bro. Like, it's, for me, I think that's actually more rare. A lot of times when you see these dudes, they're celebrities and they cheating, they sneaking, doing it behind a woman's back most of the time. That's what they're doing. They keeping it on the low. You got, I'm going to tell you where you might see women. You might see that with NBA women. And a lot of times, even NBA women are not with their man stepping out. If you watch Basketball Wives, which I don't watch, but if you watch the show, right? Like, look at Shaunie O'Neal, great example. Shaquille O'Neal talked about his wife you know, he talked about his wife. He said, man, you know, I messed that up, this. She wasn't with that man. Now, this is Shaq. This is, I mean, if you know, Shaq was the man. Shaq was Shaq, right? Like, he was the man of man. Like, he was up there. He's one of the, he was MVP guy. He was, I think he led the league in scoring. He was winning finals MVPs. It was Shaquille O'Neal, right? What happened? What did he say? I messed up. Well, why is it that you can mess up? He said, I wasn't faithful to those vows. She was at home going off on his ass. It wasn't like he could just go out there and just be plugging all these different women and showing these, okay, it's cool. You got money. We got $20, $30 million contract from the Lakers. We're good. Nah, don't go like that. He said, man, when she left my ass and I'm sitting in this 70,000 square foot mansion and I got all these bedrooms are emptied and I don't hear the kids running around no more. Nobody go to the gym. Nobody's in there playing, lifting, doing working out. That's what the kids do. He enjoyed being at home with his kids and being a family man, being a husband. And he lost that. He said, I took that for granted. He said, I messed that up. This is a guy worth millions. I'm going to tell you, let's look at Kobe. Kobe got caught up. What happened? When Kobe had that confession and he came out there, what did he do? Let's look at Tiger Woods, billionaire. What happened to Tiger? She took that golf club. We all know what she did with it. Went upside his head. He flipped the car over. Y'all remember that? I thought Tiger was, you know, not Tiger. If anybody got some money, I mean, this girl was a nanny when she met Tiger. She was a nanny, okay? She signed a prenup. But she was really just trying to be a wife, if I'm being honest. He said it. Tiger, I was just being a hoe. He knew he was. He said he took full responsibility for it. Was he trying to save his image? It doesn't matter. The problem is she wasn't with that shit. Right? Let's look at Juanita Jordan, Michael Jordan's first wife. What'd she do? My homeboy, franchise, I don't know if he's still here. I ain't gonna go into that. But yeah, it's stories with Mike. Basically, even when he was at the pinnacle of his success, Juanita, if she came around, he was doing his best to make sure she didn't know he was cheating. Michael Jordan was. When they were married. Let that sink in. I'm trying to think of guys. Let's see who could step out and it was cool. I can't think of nobody. Not off. I mean, shit. I'm going to tell you who I think maybe. Maybe like a LeBron. Or, and look, I'm not saying that NBA women don't know their man are traveling and doing what they're doing. Because that's normal. I'm sure they would think that. But if they find out, it's a problem. Yeah, Tom Brady was another one, right? You know, at the end of the day, a lot of these so-called high-value men that these guys are talking about is a fraction of a percent where a woman's going to willfully sit there and say, okay, you could cheat. Like, let's look at the type of woman that Fresh just had. She was a beautiful woman. That's the type of woman that's going to let you step out. But according to Fresh, she wasn't cool with it. But they had that conversation saying he was cool with it, but she wasn't cool with it. See what I'm saying? And so this whole thing of high value, it's like a unicorn. Like, you know what I'm saying? That's what it's damn near on the level of. Like, it's something like a four-leaf clover. Like, it's something that, yeah, it exists, but it's rare. Extremely, maybe more rare than we are willing to admit among multimillionaire men. Especially deca-millionaires. Guys that are getting north of going up, trying to approach nine-figure wet net worth. Those guys, they don't got time to be playing like that. Right? If I got a company, I built this company, and this company, me and my wife, I started a company. I got a stay-at-home wife, this and that, and that company's worth $40, $50 million. I ain't got time to be taking those types of risks and putting a gun to my head, a revolver to my head, and pulling the trigger, because that's what you're doing. Right? That guy if he is going to do something. I'm not saying everybody's faithful. I would think that a lot of these guys in this book that he's talking about, I would say more than not, most of those guys are faithful. But what I will say is, if they're not, they're sure as hell ain't cheating out in that woman's face. You know what I'm saying? 9 times out of 10. Right? That's just the bottom line. I'm not even really just going at Fresh. I'm just talking about it in general, because it's the thing that really irks me more than anything is listening to those guys, and they so confident with them damn low-level ass sex workers up there talking like that. Like, well, yeah, you know, and high value men, they should cheat. He can exercise his options. You know how hard it is for him to get on the yacht, and you had to just, all you had to do was just be pretty and put some pictures up, and you're on the yacht and getting flown to Dubai. The only way he gets there is if he buys a private jet, and he has to do this and he has to do that. So he deserves to cheat. That's the energy. Right? Tell you something. Another thing I realized that you got to realize. Even when they up there talking to sex workers, listen to what those sex workers are saying. They might be like, well, yeah, but now these are low value women. These are low class, low value skeezers. Right? These are skeezers up there on that show, right? Hussies, right? I'm going old school on y'all, right? Look at the type of women he got on the show, and look at what they say. Whenever they go on those rants and they say the things they say, it's laughable, because it's like the women are saying stuff like, well, I'm sorry, but my man ain't just getting out there. Like, these women ain't with that shit. Most of the women are even on Fresh and Fit. You would think that the skeezers that they recruit to be on that show, you would think there would be a high propensity, if you will, to accept open relationships where a man can do what he want to do on his side. And they say dumb shit like, hey, shut down your Instagram. I can have my Instagram because women use Instagram as a business to sell, to say, so just cause, and this is the thing you got to ask yourself. Well, Robert Smith, I mean, you know, it is what it is. I agree. When I found that out, I was disappointed. But what I'm saying is, when it's all said and done, what Robert Smith did was rare, to be honest with you. You really look at it. And plus, he had a real beautiful sister that he married. Yeah. And he was Ivy League. She was quality. He had a quality woman. The woman he procreated with and had his kids, she was quality. But this is the point I'm trying to make. When you look at these guys telling a woman to shut down their Instagram, right? If you're looking at a woman and saying, hey, women use Instagram to sell coochie, so you can't have Instagram. I can, because men don't use it to whatever, right? And then a girl, when he said that, one of the girls, now these are sex workers, but since you want to play chess, she said, okay, I'll shut it down, but you got to give me the passwords to your phone. Wait a minute. So wait a minute. So you shut down your Instagram, make it inactive. He gets to be on Instagram, sliding in DMs, doing what he want to do, as long as no one gets to check it. No, she can't check it. These are the rules. And the thing is, and this is where I think a lot of these guys fail to understand. A woman like, for example, Daisy Chen, right? This is where brothers don't get it. You're Fresh, you're Fit. You got this beautiful woman. You out here, you know, running through all these different women trying to do this thing, and you trying to keep her locked down. You worth $6 million. In Miami, a woman that's of a dime caliber will replace your ass in a heartbeat. All she got to do is put on a nice dress and go out in Privé or go to some club out on Sunset, and go to some spot where all the whales be, and next at Lowe's, hang out at Lowe's in the bottom of Lowe's Hotel on South Beach. Go down there and hang out. Hang out like a month, maybe 2 months. Just go out with your girls every weekend. Next thing you know, she has a roster of brothers that got just as much high value net worths. They got yachts. They got, this is what it is with pretty women. Just like a man that has money, like a great example is, let me show y'all something, man. Because I thought this was funny. But this is just a good example to show you that this stuff just, it don't work like that, man. It does not work like that. I'm going to show you. I'm going to go up here. There's a video I watched way in the morning. Let me see. Where is it? Man, this little boy was watching everything today. Let me get down here. Where is it? So this is it right here. Now I want y'all to see this right here. I want y'all to see this. Now this is DJ Academic's girlfriend, girl that he was crazy about. I think this is it. Hold on, let me go right here.
No, you got a unnormal fan base. Like, you got millions of people watching. You one of the biggest bloggers out in the world. You, how would you want to expose one of the biggest bloggers in black hip hop?
You want to talk to me? When I called you yesterday, and I called you 50 million times and finally answered, because like you're the word for guy you're with the podcast. Like, damn, why even folks keep blowing up? You know what you fucking look at me and say? Nigga, stop talking to me. I'm going on a fucking day. You know what I called you like nights ago when you were at some lady's apartment and
This Big Ack. This is DJ Academics. Copping, please, for a chick that I don't think she's all that. I'm being straight up. Maybe I'm a little biased.
Fucking little taste. You know, I was even thinking, I'm like, bro, if anytime I ever was doing bad and you called me, nigga, I fucking ran out of there trying to get home to go talk to you just to be like, baby, I'm the one you know, I love you. I'm like I'm trying. Lee, you stayed there till 7 p.m. It just told me, it was like, bro, you got this woman, she doesn't give a fuck about you. You gotta get over this shit. Because
this nigga knows she over there getting her back blowed out. He ain't even, this nigga just, bro, this nigga's in love.
Going on with her life. She wouldn't do these things to you.
She amazing? Really? She's amazing? I don't think so. I think she's okay. I think if I'm DJ Academics, I wouldn't say she's super. I would say the girl, what's her name, was dealing with look better. The Asian chick look better than her to me.
You're calling her. She doesn't even care to explain. She doesn't even care to whatever. My nigga, you were talking to her. This is what's like hurt me the most. You don't see it though. If I cheated almost, there's nothing. There's nothing that even says, baby, you know, I love you. You know, like, I was still going to spend my life with you, but like, oh, that, like, I've been literally sitting here, hurting and wondering why you won't come to me. You know, I've been, like, begging you to come. You know, I've been literally just, like, upset, hurt, damaged over you. And, like, you just ignore all that. And you're like, oh, no, the reason I don't do that is because you got a business. That's gaslighting. So, you know. Like, you don't want to talk to me when...
But yeah, though.
This the thing. Let me show y'all the girl he doing that for so y'all can see. So he telling me to share my screen, like share, pull up her Google, like she really just top notch. You know, this who he talking about. This is who Stunner Son is talking about, this girl right here. She's not an ugly girl. I'm not saying she's ugly, but I'm just saying in Miami, if I was in Miami, and I go out, this is very replaceable. Very. So, obviously, he likes her personality. Maybe she's fun to be around. And I'm not going to argue with that. Maybe she is. But, so I don't know her personality or something. It's something about her that got him to get like that about her. But the point I'm trying to make is, Act can't go out here and act a fool. He say if she find out he's cheating, she cutting the fool. And she don't give a damn about him. She put him out there. I put her name Shay Glizzy. Oh Lord, let me put it up there. Let me put the G. Lord have mercy. G. There we go. I still don't see her there. No, bro. No. That's she's I give her by I damn sure wouldn't say she a dime. She's not a dime off the rip. So that's what I'm talking about. That's not, she's not a dime. I'm not gonna say she's ugly. She's nowhere near ugly. I'm not gonna say that. I'd be hating on if I said that. But she alright. She alright, fam. She, you know what I'm saying? Like, this is what I'm talking about. I'm not finna be going crazy like that. Okay, well, I won't argue with you. I ain't gonna argue with you. The point I'm trying to make is this guy who's worth millions. These guys are worth millions. These women were worth millions. These guys are worth millions, and they can't control their women. They can't run their women like they want. Cause a girl like this, as much you see how this dude is in a stunner. If stunner gets some money, she better treat him like shit and wipe her ass with his feelings. Because this is what she clearly showing you, she ain't shit. If you do a man like that, I'm looking at you sideways. So I'm like, this your man's. He calling you, pouring his heart out to you. And this how you treat him? You is not. Then she put a video of him throwing punches or something. Like, she really been shitting on him. And he was, I'm like, bro, he's supposed to be in love with this chick. She throwing out videos. She disrespectful, bro. As hell. She disrespectful. I can't do it. Exactly. Typical IG inspired look that turns on you on pause, you basic, my boy. Yeah. And I'm going to put like this. When it's all said and done, a lot of these guys, they get these basic women on Instagram. She's an Instagram. She has the Instagram palette. She's light skin, long hair. She really don't got no big bubble ass. She just got, not necessarily, I'm talking about natural. She don't look like she got a BBL, but it doesn't necessarily mean you got to have a BBL, but she ain't just exceptional. I could probably find somebody in Montgomery to shut her down. Montgomery, Alabama. Damn sure could. Not hard to do. The point I'm trying to make is, it's not about that. What it's about is this whole myth that high-value men are so in demand that they could just cheat on a woman. The woman that you're going to cheat with, she, believe me, she got a roster of niggas herself. Ain't no woman finna, it's rare that you gonna, think about this. How many people today are willing to stay in a situation and say this nigga can cheat in your face, blatantly, have women everywhere, but you can't look at a nigga, but he got money and he gonna take you shopping. And you might, he might come home once a week and spend a day or two with you. Rest of the week, he busy. He doing other stuff. How many women would take that? I think it's a small percentage of women. At first, I think they'll say, yeah. A lot of women will say, yeah. But then when they get it, they'll be discontent. And a lot of them will wind up cheating on you. They will. A lot of them will wind up cheating. Or would they say, you know, would you rather have a guy who has money, who's successful, but he's faithful? Which one would you choose? Right. Let's say the guy that is cheating has a little bit more or more money, but you can get most of what you want with the guy that's not gonna cheat. I'm gonna take that guy to give me most of what I want, this and that. And you know, it'd be a man that she really wants to be with. This girl obviously didn't want to be with DJ Academics, and she treating him like shit for whatever reason. I don't know what he did to her. I don't know. I'm sure he did something dirty, but what I'm saying is you can see it. You know what I'm saying? No high-class lady will entertain video game / drill rap streamer, low-status profession. Yeah, for the most part. Girls walking around in London looking like that every day. See, yeah, exactly. Exactly, basic. These dudes out here going crazy. High-value men don't watch porn. I'm sure Act likes her because of his OnlyFans habit and tricking. Yeah, and it's another thing you got to look at too. It's probably something with some sexual issue did or something. It's a lot of things these guys can get. Yeah, without money. And that's the thing you got to look at too. It's this whole thing about I got money, so and I got status, I got fame. Now you're a mark, now you're a target. I wouldn't want to have that fame.
I could take the money, but I ain't got to have the fame. That's why you always people saying, man, I ain't necessarily want the fame. A lot of people want to be famous because they like attention. They want to feel special. They got low self-esteem. You don't necessarily need the money, man. The fame. The fame is going to attract the wrong type of attention, right? You a target, like when you got nice cars and you got nice clothes and jewelry. Now you got to look over your shoulder every 5 minutes. Whereas if you got you a nice $70,000 GMC truck, niggas don't know what you do. He must be in construction. They don't know. That you got it top of the line, got all the bells and whistles, everything in there, real nice, beautiful, right? Nice truck. They don't know what you do, right? And that's the guy, when you look at the millionaire next door and you listen to that, those are the types of cars they drive. That's the type of homes they live in. That's the type of wife, women they choose. When a guy that's a multimillionaire, especially in particular a deca millionaire, he's been married on average 20 years, on average. He got with his spouse. He lists his spouse as one of the top 3 to 5 reasons why he is successful. He lists his relationship with God. Top one, really, for a lot of these deca millionaires. That's one of the main reasons they take more risk. I mean, it's just the picture of the successful. So the reason I'm doing this, man, when you want to talk about being successful in America, what does it really look like when you want to be successful? Think about it. Let's broaden our horizons and expand and stop thinking that successful is a guy, because that's why we want to look successful. We want to drive the type of car to let everybody know we're successful, right? I like convertibles. I'm a convertible guy. I love convertible cars. I had a Jeep Wrangler in high school, and I just fell in love with it. And I rode a Jeep for years, and I got that Jaguar. I was convertible, and I'll probably get me another convertible. Right now, I don't have one. I sold my Jag, but I'll probably get another car that's convertible, right? I want an Aston Martin, not because I'm trying to impress somebody. I take an older Aston Martin. I don't really care. I just like Aston Martin. I like the cars, Maserati, something. If I find me a car that I want, I'm going to get it. I'm going to drive it, and that's that, right? Aston Martin is one of my favorites. If you look at those cars, they're real pretty, sleek, but I'm not trying to impress them. It's just the car that I actually like, but it might be some years before I get one. You know, but I'm not just buying a car. Like, you can find a $60,000 Ferrari Spider. You could. And you can really impress people. You know, or you can buy a truck. It depends on what you buy. Are you trying to be flashy? You trying to get a lot of attention? You trying to turn heads? Or are you just, you know, you trying to get what you want? And a lot of times, that's what we do. And we as Black people love to be flashy. So we'll get that 13, 14-year-old Ferrari and drive it around, because it's still going to look like a brand new Ferrari. It's probably going to not even have 10,000 miles on it. You know, that's what we'll do. You know, and when you look at it, it's all about flash, trying to show off, trying to show that I got something everybody else don't have. I got this, you don't. I'm driving this, you not. I got these shoes, you don't. I got this Ferragamo belt. I got this. I got that. So if you could get over that bug of trying to look successful and like you a millionaire guy, then, you know, most people are not, even the ones you see in those spaces, like when you watch those rap videos, most of those rappers are renting those cars, guys. Most people that you see on Instagram are not that damn wealthy that you see. And I'm not trying to take jabs at nobody, right? But you got people, they do a lot of flexing. And so, you know, that's another thing you got to look at is this person. Because for me, it's very easy. And it's the thing that I don't understand why guys don't get this. In this day and age, you got to be attractive as a man. You just have to. It's no longer back in the day before social media. Now a woman, you can have the most outgoing personality. You could be funny. You could be charismatic.
you are limited. Unless you out and about, you're very limited in your choices. Now, when you talk about social media, she go click on them pictures. So it's what she sees. So it takes a certain level of style and a certain level of expertise into making yourself attractive to a woman as a man. And a lot of guys don't like hearing that. So then, you know, I'm telling you, you got to work out. You got to learn. You got to dress a certain way, right? You got to learn how to take pictures. This is stuff that if you're talking about getting with women nowadays, these are the things that you do. But that doesn't necessarily mean spend thousands of dollars on dumb shit. Doesn't mean that. I've seen people like, you know, this guy. Let me see if I can find him. There are certain people that got, they have these, let me see. Let me go here. And you got people that got these Instagram accounts, but they're not. I don't think this dude here, like, here you go right here. This brother right here. You look at his content. He ain't really got a lot of videos showing off money. Really, it's just him. Now, he's just showing his body off. But if you look at Stephen Beck as an example, most of this ain't like money stuff. This ain't about money. Now, all he want to do is show his body off. But, you know, he done got a lot bigger than he used to be. But what I'm saying is, you look, it's mostly just exercise content, man. That's all it is, most of it. So I say all that to say, these are the things that you got to do, learn how to do to take pictures. And this is what women want to see. They want to see shit like that. You know what I'm saying? No homo. No Diddy, obviously. Right? No Diddy. But it is what it is. Why men don't be mad, women don't value them. Be ready, but ready kick another man's ass over a woman, not his. All right, let's see what we got. Then I spent $100 on this just to say, yeah. Just to say, like, nigga, you ain't up on this. Exactly. Like Jay Morrison, nigga was flexing and lost $12 million on the phone. Boy, tell me about it. Tell me about it. Now he's selling that damn property. That nigga better not ever show his face again doing nothing. I definitely like to hear your thoughts on the latest developments of Jay Morrison and the Tulsa Real Estate Fund. Yeah, I mean, he's a fraudster, bro. Just a straight fraudster. He could have taken that $11-12 million, dropped, if he really did have it, and dropped it in like certain fund. But he lived a certain way. I cooled off on him once he tried to sell tickets to his wedding. I was through with him at that point. I said, "Oh yeah, nah, this nigga." I thought, okay, he's getting advice. He claimed he was getting advice from people, financial advisors. That's what he never said. He was the one that was managing it. He said it's people, the financial advisors, not me, because he was getting drilled and he was always trying to say that it wasn't him doing it. But he was just the face of it, which was bullshit. Average looking, we attract little to personality values, et cetera. So I wonder why, how you would have ended up if you was 5'6". I still would have ended up being good, but guess what? I'm not. So I don't have that problem. Sorry, brother. Add another 6, 7, 8 inches on that. Then that's me. Sorry. That's not my problem. You 5'6"? Hey, that's, you got work to do. I still would have been okay, though. I don't think I'd have had a problem with women. I still would have been okay. Would I have gotten as many as I probably did get? No, I probably would have. It probably been, I'd probably have to put in more work, but I would have put the work in because that's my attitude. I got to put the work in. And I wouldn't have been a basketball player more than likely. So it is what it is, you know. The really looking men come with a lot most of the time. All the women want them. It can be a headache. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm just saying as a guy, your social media presence is a must. Like, you got to learn to master these types of things. Like, you cannot be out here half-assing it as a man. You just can't.
can't half-ass it, bro. This is my homeboy. This the homie, right? But you see how he put his shit together. I'm not mad at him. Not a hater. Y'all see how he put his shit together. This is your competition. When you, some of y'all, so a girl trying to talk to a dude. Now, I don't know. I don't think he got that kind of money. I don't know. I ain't talked to him in a while. He might have crossed over. But he doing well for himself, though. He ain't broke. He doing good. What I'm saying is these types of profiles, man, the way you put your shit together is of utmost importance. I don't understand why brothers don't get that. Why they don't understand that shit. This is important, fam. That's just how it is. So competition is a must. You got to be a competitor. Okay, any nigga lose $12 million, made $12 million. Okay, he a real Dusty. Yeah. It is what it is. It is what it is. What's up, Reaper? What's up, man? Like I said, man, I just wanted to come up here. I'd rather have the social media I have now, which isn't much, but really be like that in real life unless online mating is your thing. I'm going to be honest with you. If I was a single man, it'd be so easy. Hey, man, that shit easy. Social media is so easy. Like, I don't get why brothers. Because first of all, most brothers ain't going. They not going out like, they not looking like this. They not doing this. They not doing what my boy doing, Jay Hines. They not on it like that. I'm going to wear some shit like this. That's what I'm going to wear. That's how I'm dressing. When I'm out, that's what I'm wearing. That's how I'm coming. That's what I would do. I would do the same type of stuff he does on my social media. That's what I would do. Not because it's on some, you know, trying to impress, but shoot, if you're going to compete, then compete. If it's a competition, then damn it, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to bring it. That's how I'm coming. That's what I'm going to do. Got to get it to my boy. He be clean as hell now. But that's how you do. Y'all know I love these jackets. Love them. Love them. I got one just like that. I got a red one. Just like that. That's how you do it. You can't be lazy. You got to get off your ass and you have to compete. That's just the bottom line, you know. I don't think it's as difficult as we make it out to be as men. It really isn't. Let me see. Let me go to my boy channel. Yesterday, he put a video up. I want you to check it out. Let me see. Where did he put that video up? I started it yesterday. So I'm going to check my boy out. So check my boy out right here. So this is my boy right here, Brandon. Brandon Carter. And y'all know I love Brandon Carter. I used to watch his stuff all the time. But you a man, you got to do that shit, bro. If you're not doing that and you whining about your options and but these women, men are single. They're single because y'all niggas ain't doing nothing. And the ones that's doing it, they mopping up. You got to be competitive. That's what it is. You ain't going to compete, then shut up.
When you came out with your content and you started talking about, I think you guys called it looks maxing.
I mean, making yourself more attractive, term for that got popularized is called looks maxing, which means maximizing your looks, which is essentially, it's been a trend, I would say, the past year and a half.
Yeah.
And the big reason is because guys are starting to realize how much looks really do matter.
It does matter, right? You can't be a fucking mutant, right? So, okay, so it has to matter a little bit. So it's just how much, maybe the discrepancy with some of the old school people, because guys, is like, how much does it matter?
Mm-hmm.
Right. But I think it's just like anything, it makes things easier.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Well, everything also evolves. So the old school pickup guys, looks matter less in that time frame. Actually, it was more about charisma, social skills, other attraction triggers and pillars about you as a man.
Mm.
Nowadays, with the popularity of online dating, Instagram, you know, things where it's very image heavy.
Mm.
That's where guys are starting to realize, like, hey,
me being charismatic isn't going to get me matches on Tinder. Me being charismatic is not going to get a girl to DM me.
Okay, so what you're saying is it might have mattered less when the primary way to meet women was in person. But when he's doing it online, and now that there's these dating apps and all this other shit, you need looks to get it, to even get in the door. Yeah. Where like in person, you can be fucking wacky or do some shit and get her attention. And then maybe like, you know,
even in person nowadays, like looks still matter like slightly less than online, because you can have other things about yourself that can convey you to be more attractive.
Yeah, there's a lot of things you can do in person that you can't do online, and vice versa.
Exactly. But at the end of the day, I have found that there's a bit of a congruency between how much looks matters online versus in person, meaning that it still matters.
It still matters in person, right? Just because it's easier. Like, it's easier. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, a girl might come up to you in person if you look right, you know? If you're her type or whatever, it happens.
Mm-hmm.
You know
exactly.
I've heard. And
yeah, me too.
Yeah, you heard, right?
I've heard
stories about it. So, and when I saw you were the first person I've seen coming out with that content, maybe because I wasn't like so much in the red pill space and all that shit, but and just because I knew you. But it seems like it's something that you've really focused on. Is that true? Like, you focused on like maximizing your looks.
Yeah. And the reason is because within my dating strategy, I found that made the biggest difference. And then other guys who I was teaching, and even friends of mine who teach the same thing, that made the biggest difference in their dating lives too.
Yeah,
it's going to make a difference. That, I mean, people don't like that shit, but that's really the crux of the matter, fam. It is, as a man, women want something they can look at. And that's not,
because guys would ask me advice for about getting girls. I'm like, what am I gonna tell you, man? Get fucking, become a 6 foot tall multimillionaire with single digit body fat. That's what I did.
Yeah,
that's it. So I can't tell you. I can't teach that. But then I found, then you show me, hey, you can teach some of that.
Yeah, and funny you say that, because more than half of that still revolves around your looks.
Exactly.
Being ribbed, body fat percentage, the only thing that doesn't is obviously your income, finance level, right?
Yeah. Well, you know, I here's something that I noticed. I've been through all different economic brackets, from South Side Chicago over there where Chief.
If I'm under 6 feet, my body fat gonna be single digit. I mean, I'm a damn near have single digit body fat. If you slacking, if you under like Stunner Son to my, he 5'6", whatever he is, your ass need to be in the gym every day, all day. You need to be eating right. You need to be, because that's gonna give you more options. This show competition right here on the screen, fam. You ain't got to do much. You really don't. Don't walk around with your hair all knotty looking like the rest of them niggas. Keep your shit crispy. That's what I would do. But hey, I'm mopping up. I would mop up.
Keeping them motherfuckers up from, you know, all the way to, you know, here, you know, fucking Miami, Biscayne Boulevard and shit, penthouse apartments, and everywhere in between. And what I noticed is even the women in better neighborhoods, a lot of times they look better, but because they have more fucking money. You can hear me out, because you've seen this before. You got a girl, she's like an 8'9", right? At least that's what you think. Mm-hmm. Then you see her without the makeup and without all the shit, and it's like, oh, this bitch is a 6 or a 7, right? But women have all these strategies that make themselves look better, but that shit costs money.
Facts. I always say women are the original looks maxers.
Ain't they?
They've been doing this for a long time. guys are just getting on game now, because this is where I guess this mattered the most in this day and age. But it's always mattered to women. That's why, you know, makeup and all these other things exist.
Yeah, man. And it's like, I, you know, me growing up, it was different, because I grew up in, a history of violence. And for me, it was about looking more.
So guys, take a look at this picture right here I just took. Some might say, oh, you're very photogenic, or you just take nice pictures, but it's actually very strategic. In fact, I'm gonna tell you in this video 5 tips that you can start doing right now so that you can start taking better pictures just like that. And I've been using these tips.
You got dudes out here telling y'all this shit, man. Y'all niggas still can't, like, bro, I don't get it. I don't get these niggas talking about they can't get no woman. That shit is
for years. I use it for.
I ain't need none of this to get no one. None of it. Because I was an in-person type nigga, but I would look like, I ain't looking on the internet. I'm in person, period. But
my clients, and overall, if you want
to be in the top 10% when it comes to overall presenting yourself, when it comes to your Instagram, your online dating profiles, you definitely need these tips, all right? So without further ado, let's go ahead and get right into it. Now, the very first tip is that you have to understand good lighting. Lighting can make or break a picture, and it really can make your picture stand out or make it just overall horrible. And here's my biggest tip in order to find good lighting. You're gonna do the hand trick. The hand trick is a way to see which position the sun is oriented. So right here, the sun is facing towards me. That's why I look bright. That's why I just look presentable, right? But some of you guys will take the picture and the sun will be sort of behind you like this, right? It doesn't look the same. Let's switch that around. So in order to do the hand trick, here's what you're gonna do. You're gonna hold your palm up and just overall turn it. And then you're gonna see, based on the sun's orientation, which side is the most lit up and has the most even lighting. So right here, I can tell that my hand's the most even lighting because the sun is right there. However, when I turn it, it's casting a shadow on the left side. So we don't wanna take the picture from over here. Turn it back, you can't see it, but my hand is completely dark. Over here, it's a little bit even, but it's not as even as right here. So anytime I'm out on photo shoots, anytime I'm about to take a picture of myself, I always do the hand test just to check which way should I be facing. Ideally, you always wanna be facing towards the sun. The sun light.
I mean, you got guys giving you guys instructions on how to be successful with this type of stuff. It's really not that hard.
Yo, what's up, everybody?
Really not that hard. Like how we love to try to make it.
One of the biggest things I noticed whenever I started making myself more attractive is how women started treating me. Honestly, it was a night and day difference. However, it's not all sunshine and rainbows. Whenever a woman perceives you to be handsome or especially more attractive than themselves, they can start to act a bit weird. So today we're gonna discuss how women really act whenever they find you attractive, positive, and a little negative. So stay tuned. Now, you guys have seen the videos where I'm reading my dating app messages. I'm reading out how women reply to me or send me cold DMs. And with that being said, one of the biggest things I've noticed is that women just start to lead with validation. Now, overall in the dating space, especially in the red pill dating space, as men, we're taught to not do that. However, as humans, it's our natural reaction to just validate somebody that we're highly physically attracted towards. However, if you notice, women tend to just overall do this less. And once you actually experience this, you will start to realize like, damn, like women have been doing this the whole time. It just takes the right guy. And that right guy, as I said before, somebody they perceive to be handsome, usually in the 7.5+ range. Now, you don't have to objectively be like 7.5 to 8. It's whatever she perceives you to be. So meaning that you perfectly fit her type. You're the archetype who she has a physical imprint towards. Whatever it may be, something about you just does it for her. And for that reason, she has absolutely no ego and she's willing to make that connection for you in the easiest way possible. Now, this is actually a big part of my dating strategy. I like to call it inbound game, meaning that the leads are coming to you. And for that reason, overall, it just makes dating a lot easier. And for that reason, you don't have to chase. As guys, you
know, exactly. This dude,
growing up.
If I was succinct, if I was a kid trying to learn, this is who I watch.
We are just taught to chase and chase women. Once again, lead with that validation. But whenever you have it,
I'll be hitting that damn weight room. Them weights will work wonders for you. I'm telling you what I know.
Flipped and turned towards you, it's just a 9-day
difference. It worked wonders for me. I still was getting off when I was skinny, but damn it, when I started putting on muscle and got a little chest and arms and man, that shit. And I started buying polos and shit that would fit a certain way, bro. I mopped up.
Difference, and it just makes everything so much easier, guys. Now, this is mostly online stuff. Of course, you know, Digital Romeo, this is where a lot of my experience has happened. However, this also happens in person too. The biggest one perhaps is choosing signals. You know, I've made a few videos talking about choosing signals, how to get more of them. And definitely whenever you make yourself more attractive and a girl finds you.
He cut the sleeves off because he's trying to show one of his better features, which he feels like is his arms. So he cut the sleeves off, fam. And see, I'm the type of nigga do some shit like that because I would get talked to niggas. Oh, look at this nigga. He think he a pretty boy. This nigga all got his chest out. This nigga, Yeah, I used to hear that shit all the time. Look at this nigga coming in here like he a model or some shit. You damn right, nigga. Damn right, I'm coming in that bitch, getting it. Y'all niggas, say what you want. Man, this nigga be dressing like a white boy. Like, look what he got on. You niggas used to tell me that shit. I know, forget that. It's
funny how niggas would say that shit. I didn't know what a hater was back then. But now, I know what a hater is. And now I'm like, nigga, you was hating. Listen, I remember they tore down the old school I went to in high school, Carver, right? So before they tore it down, they had like a weekend like barbecue. It was up there with music. Radio was up there and shit. So all the people from Carver came back. All of them was in the gym. Talking about people from the 90s, the 80s, the early 2000s. Everybody was there, right? So I go, and you know, I ain't dressed up. I just had on like a little, it's really had on a t-shirt. That's all I had on. I had on a little t-shirt. It was like a, what was it? It was like a Marvel Comics t-shirt, like an old throwback look, right? So I put the shirt on, but the shirt was a little fitted, you know. But, I ain't give a shit. So, this, you know, I'm just up there just to hang, just talking to everybody. I don't like some shorts. Some blue jean shorts, dark. I like dark denim. I don't wear no light denim. Dark, damn near navy blue denim. Dark, right? And I like to roll my, the bottom of them. I like to roll it up a little bit. Some up there, I got my little shoes on. I'm chilling. Not dressed up, just hanging. So girls was coming up to me and, oh, you done filled out. You done, I mean, you were skinny, but you looking good. You done filled out. You aged well. And these was girls that were a little bit older than me that I remember I used to like. You know what I'm saying? But now I'm like, I'm a grown-ass man. I really didn't care. I was talking to somebody at the time, so I wasn't trying to really get in a serious thing with anybody or something. But, you know, it was just a little flirtatious thing. So I'm kind of going back and forth. We talking or whatever. And I remember this nigga named Hopney. He lives in Dallas, that bitch-ass nigga. I don't like his ass to this day because this nigga was hating on me. Y'all heard you hating on me. Heard that nigga hating on me, so fuck you too. Shit. To this day, this nigga talking about me. I'm like, damn, man. What? My homeboy told me, I'm like, man, what that nigga talking about? What he talking about me for? Nigga ain't seen me in years. Anyway. So this nigga, he had this little weird ass voice. He would all, man, you come up here with this little shirt on trying to show your little muscles and shit. What it is, the nigga shorter than me. Hop always had a body. Like, he always worked out, was all, but he was like that in high school. But he looked the same, but I done filled out. So I guess he up there, all of us was talking, but the girls kept coming to me while I'm talking to the fellas. And he, look at you. You come up here trying to show your little chest off. Nigga, I see you. So, you know, I laugh, but I had one of my homeboys was working with me at the time. This is when I was doing real estate. And my homeboy was like, he was younger. So he was like, man, who this bitch ass nigga? I said, oh yeah, man, that's nigga, man, from high school. He said, man, that nigga a hater, bro. He a hater, bro. He jealous. So you think so? Like, yeah, man, that nigga a hater, dog. Look at him. That nigga watching you. When a girl come up to you, he always got to be having something to say. And this girl, one girl named Tamika, I ain't going to say her last name. She walked up. Everybody was crazy about her. She still look good. Tamika, 50-something. Tamika's a star, right? She came up to me. Hey, what's up? Hey, I think I got her number too. I had got her number. I was like, we was talking now. That's one. I was like, I got to get this motherfucker number. But I got her number. We talked. We texted a little bit. We never talked because I think she got married like a year later. I never really got out of like that. But even still, but I remember that nigga was sitting there and when my boy said something, I started paying attention. I noticed this nigga was watching me. So I ain't saying that, you know. So fast forward about a year, 2 years later, I'm talking. Actually, Meat, the dude that was on my channel, shout out to my homeboy Meat, Jamie, the one that came on my channel that time. You know, me and him had a little back and forth last week about Flat Earth. But anyway, he was telling me, yeah, man, I saw Hopney, man, at the gym. I said, oh, okay, what are you up to? I don't know, man. I told him I talked to you, man. And he's like, man, you still talk to him, man. Why you talk to him? Like, and I'm like, what the fuck you say that for? Cause I was like, I ain't never did shit to this nigga. Never did nothing to him. Jealous. A fucking hater. I love niggas like that. Love them. I love niggas like that. I'm dressing. When I come around, I'm chopping your head, nigga. When I see you,
Yes, I'm going to come around you looking good. I'm going to smell good. I'm going to have on the nice shit just to fuck you up, just to make you mad. I love to mess with haters. Love them. Niggas up here talking about, man, why you still dealing with that nigga? Why you still like, bro, like, he had like, I don't know. It's like, I guess it's some, he's talking like there is some consensus that I'm a bitch ass nigga. Like it was just understood. I'm a villain. And we talking about shit from like 20 some odd, damn near 30 years ago at the time now. We talking about north of 20 some odd years when this nigga said this, that we was in high school. And I'm just like, bitch ass nigga, what? Like that fuck nigga. Man, fuck that shit, man. I said, man, I do what I told, man, and I told that nigga what it was. I'm like, even still, why this whole ass nigga bringing my name up, talking about why you fucking with me like I'm some bitch nigga or something. And I'm like, I can't, I'm like, what the fuck is he talking about? Why this nigga said that? Like it's a commonly accepted belief that I'm a bitch ass nigga. Fuck you. So next time that nigga see me, I ain't got shit to say to his whole ass. Real shit. And I'm going to the little thing they had this year. The little fest thing they have with the high school. I'm going there. I'm going to be there. I hope his bitch ass is there. Let's go.
To be like a 7.5 or
I got
8.
To dress up when I go, damn. I got to dress. I got to look good when I go.
Plus, she is going to choose hard. She's going to stare. She's going to get her friends to approach you. She's going to some way figure out how to make that connection with you. And it happens like literally every time you go out to a social environment. So that's what I'm saying. Like, if you're a young guy right now, if you're in college, if you're 18, 19, 20, and you're in that environment to where you can get chose a lot and it's very easy for you to meet women on a daily basis, bro, the number one thing you should be doing right now is trying to make yourself more attractive and more handsome, because that's what's going to give you the highest return on investment. Now, recently, I was watching my favorite movie of all time, White Chicks. And in this one scene, Latrell, the star basketball player, he won the bid to take one of the white chicks out to dinner. And so throughout this dinner scene, something interesting happens. The girl slash guy is in his best way trying to turn off Latrell as much as possible, biting his fingernails, spitting in the wine, ordering copious amounts of food and just eating it in a crazy way. Now, Latrell's face is kind of turned off by it, but in the end, guess what? He didn't care. And as I was watching, I was like, yo, this makes perfect sense, because whenever a woman or even a man finds somebody highly attractive, they're just overall super forgiving. Super forgiving in terms of these icks. You know, we're in this ick economy nowadays. And whenever a woman perceives you to have an ick and she's turned off by it, that means she wasn't highly physically attracted to you. Because trust me, whenever a woman perceives you as a 7.5, 8+, they're going to be super forgiving towards these icks, and they're going to justify every reason to still be attracted towards you. So for that reason, you can truly just be yourself. Now, you still want to have, to some degree, social skills and the ability to, you know, have game and be a bit of a charismatic sort of guy. However, you don't have to follow the strict playbook of trying to say exactly the right things, trying to say exactly the right line, trying to walk exactly in the perfect way, right? Because she finds you to be super handsome. So that's one thing that I just overall realized is that just they're super.
A lot of times, man, people, I see people whining in this damn space. Oh, man, you know, the guy that's attractive, man, he doesn't necessarily have to be, you know, he doesn't have to do. Yeah. So why don't you work on becoming that guy? Well, if you just ugly and you look like Shrek, you can at least work out. You can at least work out. But what that gonna do? That's gonna put you in the game. You could be ugly and work out and get women just on your body. Man, you lying. Bro, I've been around women. I know how women talk. They'll tell you that nigga ugly, but he got a nice body. That nigga fine. They talk just like we do. Guys, think about that chick that ain't the best looking in the face. She's not ugly per se, like just not the best looking, but she got a hell of a body. You might fuck with her. You would probably be, some brothers will date her and be with her ass. Okay, yeah, she ain't number the six, but man, that motherfucker, her body's a 10 though. And so a brother will treat her like she a 8. Like that's what he'll do. He'll be in love, and he'll be happy with her. So I tell women, get to the damn weight room. It's them curves and how you look matter. What you look like in them panties is of utmost importance. if you pull that shirt and lift that shirt up and you got flat stomach, little small, you know, woman stomach, little bitty abs, not the ripped up manly abs, but just a little something, and you know, you got that nice ass that's in proportion with your waist and your hips. And bro, that nigga ain't going nowhere. He ain't going nowhere. He ain't. He ain't going nowhere. All this is shit you can get in the gym. And I see some of the most box-shaped women work wonders in the weight room. So you could do it. But that's what I'm saying. This whole idea, I think that's something we should have. We should have a long-term pro. I'm going to be honest with you. Just about anybody can in a six to 9 months from just being fucked up. I'm talking about gut, everything. I say 6 to 9 months, you can be physically appealing. If you walking around and you ain't just completely out of shape, 2 months. 2 months of discipline. Get your shit down. In 2 months, I could be down about 12, roughly. Yeah, I probably could. If I box 5 days a week, I can go down to 12% body fat. Easy. Right, I'll be hovering right there. I have to watch my diet too. If I'm boxing 5 days a week, I'm burning a lot. I'm burning 3,500 calories a day. Because today I burned. Oh, shoot, my watch reset because it's after midnight. But today I probably burnt like 3,000 on the dot. I have to look at my phone. It'll tell me what I burnt yesterday. But that's what I'm saying. Those calories and how much you're burning, you get your Fitbit and you just work it, you'll be all right. Nope, I only burned 2,800 yesterday. Damn. Or today, should we say. So it is what it is.
Super, super forgiving. And also, she'll just overall make temporary trade-offs towards your sexual market value. So, you know, she finds you really attractive, but maybe you're not in the right financial space you want to be right now. Maybe you can't necessarily provide her the experiences that she necessarily wants to. She'll be forgiving towards certain things regarding your SMB, at least for a short amount of time. Whereas somebody she.
I'm sure Kevin Samuels in Obsidian would argue with you on that capstone, but I agree with you. I ain't going to say four. That's a big ass jump. Four is a big jump to an eight. But I can think a four can jump to a six for a lot of dudes. And I've seen an eight jump to a 10. Shit, I've seen a seven jump. I've seen sevens that dudes go crazy over and damn near getting an accident staring at. And she bought a seven. She's noticeably attractive. And niggas lose their damn mind. I've seen it. And I've seen women that are a seven, eight, or nine get treated like they top of the line dime women. I've seen it. And I've seen women that are sevens that dudes treat them like a seven. Like, which is, you know, doesn't mean, when you say treat, doesn't mean a bad thing. But they not looking at like, oh my gosh, she's stopping traffic. But she's a beautiful woman. Right? And that's cool too. You know what I'm saying? Everybody ain't gonna be out here just, you know, at the top. Like I've had women think I was all that, and I had women that thought I was all right. You know, I'm cool either way. I'm cool with that. You're not. And a lot of times with women, what's funny about a woman won't even notice you when she first see you. She might think you're attractive. She's like, oh, yeah, you're a cute guy. That's what they'll say. No diddy, right? But when it's all said and done, when you start talking to her, and when y'all get in that space where y'all done really got to know each other, and when y'all laying in the bed and y'all done did the do, and now she's sitting there telling you the truth, she'll tell you, oh yeah, I remember the day you walked in. I thought you was really attractive and I was scared to say something to you. And I was like, well, damn. When I saw you, you didn't even look at me. She's like, yeah, but I mean, I play it off like you would never know. But women like that. They're very, sometime with a woman, they'll be checking you out. You won't even know it. They're a lot better than men. Men, we got to look at that ass. We might sit there and laugh and be talking, not looking. Soon as she get past us, you look at her. Then you turn real quick. Like, you know, I just had to check out, see what she working with. That's us. Women, you'll never know. There are women I dated that never, I would have, in a million years, I would have thought they ever thought I was attractive.
I just didn't think that. And then we finally somehow connect. And then I'm talking to her and I'm realizing she thought I was extremely attractive. And she, you know, some of the stuff they'll say, especially when you intimate with a woman like that. Because when you get intimate with them, they'll tell you what they really feel. Because it's over now. Right? The game is over. You out and did to do. So now she's like, okay, I'm going to tell you the truth, what I really think. And she, and you'd be like, dang, I never thought you really thought I was this or that. Or, you know, oh, yeah, I'm good at hiding it. Women are very good at hiding it and masking how they really feel about a man. In the sense of, I'm talking about at first. When they first see you, you never know. What he's talking about, I think this guy lives in Miami, so he's out. He's walking around. Women going to Miami a lot of times to date and meet men. And so he's going to get a better reaction than normal. But every day, let's say you go to the gym and work out. Like, I never forget this girl I like. I was crazy about her, too. This girl is said to be the baddest girl in the state of Alabama. Okay? Like, I'm talking that damn. And that's saying a lot. All right? There were dudes that said she was the baddest, straight certified. She a dime. Certifiable. Right? Certifiable dime. I'm not lying. Right? Bro, I used to come in the gym every day. I would look at her, but I would play it. You know, I would play it like I ain't really checking her out. You know, I'd be like, oh, hey, how you doing? I'm going to keep walking. All mother niggas, hey, what's up, baby? What's up? You know, and I'm just chilling. I'm never saying nothing to her. Never trying to holler at her. But I remember thinking, like, whenever I got up close to her, I would be looking in her face like, oh, my God, this girl is flawless. Like, just flawless. And I remember never hollering at her. And so some kind of way, I can't remember, we started talking. I think my homeboy cut my hair, kind of alluded to it. And she was with it because he worked there. They had a barber, his World's Gym. They had a bar. He's a cut up front, my homeboy Tim from New York. And he told her, yeah, I got somebody I think you need. So she said, who? And she told him, oh, she said, really? Yeah, he a nice guy. She said, you think he always say, oh, yeah. Yeah, he thinks you're attractive. She's like, you know, she didn't know. He called me. And, you know, we hooked up. Went out a couple of times or whatever. That never came of it. But the point I'm trying to make is she told me, eventually she said, you know what? She said, you didn't come at me like the rest of the dudes were. I didn't even think you found me attractive. I was like, really? I'm thinking myself, girl, you out your damn mind. Like, you know. But I remember that, but it was you have to play it like that. And a lot of times with women, especially beautiful women, ignoring them is the best way to get their attention. So obviously it raised my value in her mind because I wasn't just taken. Like, oh my God, she is just such a dime. I wasn't acting like that. I was just like, now in my mind, I was going crazy. But she never knew because I'm just walk my little thing, hit my little keychain thing on the little scanner. Hey, how you doing? And I'm going in there and working out. Got my headphones on. I ain't even really halfway talking. I'm just, you know, so I noticed she was, you know, so when we finally did talk, it was weird because it was like she was telling me how she never thought I thought I would. She liked that I wasn't always. She said, I ain't see you always trying to talk to step to. I'm like, yeah, I'm in the gym to work out. Why am I being there trying to? You know, but in my mind, I was checking her out like, oh, my God, this girl is the truth. So it is what it is, man. But what we got? You got to act like you don't want them. Exactly. Beauty is subjective, but character, in my opinion, more important, at least to me. Everyone is different. Now, that's important to me, too. Yeah, that retrospective talk will reveal women's are slick when they notice you. Yeah, bro. Yeah, man, I'm telling you, like, women I got with, in fact, shit, my wife was like that. I met her, I stepped to her, I saw her in the mall, I saw her, I thought she was attractive, so I went up to her, I was asking her something, she was working at a cell phone booth at the time, this is when she had just graduated, so I went up, we talking, me and my homeboy, and so I said, yeah, I said, let me get your number. She said, okay. And then a customer walked up. So I took my phone out. I gave it to her. She said, hold on. I said, put your number in my phone. She said, no, I'm waiting. I'm working with a customer right now. I ain't get mad. I said, okay, cool. So I waited. I guess she thought that was going to run me off. But I just stood there, waited. She gave me the number. I called her. We went out. The rest is history. But I remember when I talked to her, it was like, I didn't really think she thought nothing like that as far. It wasn't until later we started talking. Then once we got intimate and stuff, that's when she started telling me what she really thought I was. But at first, she was kind of standoffish. Nah, take it or leave it. Wasn't no big deal. That's the energy she gave me. You don't know a woman what they think. A lot of times, you got to understand, they human just like you are. They got the same insecurities. Shit, strippers are human. Even the women that you see that are some considered, you know, well, they gaming you. They still work like other women. They still are, but you don't pull your wallet out trying to get a woman like that. That's stupid. But that's neither here nor there. Anyway, I got to go. All right, guys. God bless y'all. Y'all have a good one.